Johnson himself, is he in? Yes! Oh my goodness!
The infamous fifth down fiasco. The CU Buffaloes were unknowingly granted an extra down on their final drive of the day. And on that fifth down, quarterback Charles Johnson scored, and CU beat Missouri 33-31. It was the most bizarre story of the 1990 college football season, and it only became more bizarre. Shortly after the game, CU head coach Bill McCartney focused his attention not on the fifth down controversy, but on the field itself, calling Missouri's artificial turf, quote, an embarrassment to college football.
Now, the thing that upsets me is that field is not playable college football. Nobody should have to come in here and play on that surface. I'd rather play in a parking lot than that thing.
Well, that just infuriated Missouri even more. Debate raged for months. The game officials were each suspended one game, and the tainted win helped CU eventually capture the Big 8 title, earn a trip to the Orange Bowl, and win a national championship. One year later, much has been said about CU's tainted victory and how it affected the very foundation of the 1990 season. And now, it's Colorado and Missouri once again, this time on the Buffs' home turf.
We've felt the wrath of this thing for almost a year. And say that it's not a factor in this year's game is nonsense.
Channel 4 Sports presents CU Buffaloes football. Live from Folsom Field in Boulder, it's the University of Missouri Tigers versus the University of Colorado Buffaloes.
Good afternoon, everybody. I'm Les Shapiro along with Dave Logan, and there is plenty to motivate CU in Missouri today. CU, of course, begins defense of its Big 8 title. Missouri opens its conference schedule also, but maybe with a little more on their mind, Dave.
Well, certainly Missouri remembers last year, and so do the Colorado Buffaloes. Missouri off to their best start since 1982. Bob Stoll feels like this team can get into a bowl if they continue to play well. He also thinks last year, if he had three plays back, they might have been 7-4 instead of 4-7. But because of last year's fifth down scenario, I think emotions will run much higher this afternoon on both sides of the field.
Both coaches have tried to downplay that controversial situation from last year. Bob Stoll has gone so far as to try and not talk about it at all in public.
Well, Bob Stoll may not talk about it to the media, but rest assured he has talked about it to his players, as has Bill McCartney. I think both coaches will use what happened last year individually to try to motivate their clubs.
All right, when we get back, we'll talk about some key players missing from Missouri's lineup today, and we'll give you the starting lineup.
Today's game is brought to you by Samsonite and by Grease Monkey, both proud companies for Colorado, and also by Racket World, by McDonald's, by Farmers Insurance, and by Coors Light.
A McDonald's break.
Yeah, a Big Mac.
Fries.
Yeah, large fries.
An ice-cold medium Coke Classic.
Oh, give me a break.
Everything, all of it, right now, just $2.99.
$2.99 for all that?
Are we getting a break?
Yeah.
A Big Mac sandwich, large fries, and a medium Coke, all for just $2.99? That's incredible.
Nah, that's just one of the great value meals at McDonald's today.
It's Oktoberfest at your Jeep and Eagle dealers. Yes, you could don an attractive short outfit, but we think you'd look better in a new Eagle Talon at this great price. Or a new Jeep Cherokee with cash back and Olympic discounts. You could buy this, but it's easier to fit your family into this. A new Summit wagon with air conditioning at no extra charge. Don't miss the Jeep and Eagle Oktoberfest, where you'll say, skip the Wiener Schnitzel, Hilda. I want a new car.
See your local Jeep Eagle dealer.
Boy, have we been lucky this year. Another gorgeous day at Boulder's Folsom Field. We have yet to have to bring a coat up to Boulder for any of these ball games this year. Weather conditions, beautiful. The temperature is 79 degrees, very slight wind out of the southeast, and it's only going to get sunnier and warmer as the day goes on. This is homecoming for CU. The alumni marching band in the stands, a lot of the former cheerleaders and pom-pom people from years past here to help out the current squads. The Buffs ready to take the field along with Ralphie, the mascot. Right now, the coin toss at midfield. And here comes Ralphie. As Ralphie finishes a run, we find out that CU will receive the kickoff to begin the first half. Dave, Coach McCartney very worried about his team's consistency coming off the loss at Stanford 2 weeks ago, especially the consistency on defense.
Well, it was Bill McCartney's probably one of his top most disappointing losses in his tenure here. They just didn't go out and execute, and there were times when they just didn't play hard. That's something that as a coach you cannot accept. So they have worked very hard in practice the last couple of weeks. Physically, they've been banged up a little bit. Darian Hagan, the quarterback, has an assortment of injuries, but he is going to play. They need his leadership in the game. They obviously need his skill in the game, but Hagan, I would say, today is probably about 80% healthy. You see some of his numbers, 5 touchdown passes against 2 interceptions. Hagan has thrown effective when they've given him an opportunity to throw.
Hagan coming off a bout with the flu this week, and then last week, a nagging hamstring, knee, and ankle injury. He has proven to be very fragile in the last couple years up here in Boulder. As for Missouri, they've got a wonderful passing game. They lead the Big 8, and the man in charge of that passing game is quarterback Phil Johnson.
I think today you'll have a chance to see one of the up-and-coming stars of the Big 8 Conference, Phil Johnson, at 6'5 and 205 pounds. He's a 4.5 40 guy, which gives him great elusiveness. You can't pin him in the pocket. He can run away from the pass rush. You see his numbers, almost 1,000 yards so far this season, 7 touchdowns and 6 interceptions. They average close to 270 yards a game throwing the football. That will be something that certainly will challenge CU here this afternoon.
One problem for Johnson and Missouri as we look at the series record, the Tigers lead it altogether. That should be 33-19-3. However, the Buffs have won the last 6 meetings. The problem for Johnson and Missouri today is he is missing 2 of his key receivers. Starting wideout Victor Bailey did not make the trip. He has a bad shin. Starting tight end Byron Chamberlain did not make the trip. He has an ankle injury. He is the leading pass catcher in the Big 8. And on the defensive side for Missouri, they will be missing their left tackle on the defensive line, Rick Lyle. He made the trip. However, he will not be in uniform because of an injury. The Buffs take the field, getting ready to receive the kickoff. CU 2-2 on the year. Missouri with its best schedule, its best record going into the conference schedule at 2-1-1. This is the conference opener for both teams. CU going for back-to-back-to-back titles, trying to earn its 3rd consecutive trip to the Orange Bowl. Back to receive the kickoff for CU will be Chris Hudson and Charles Johnson. And kicking off for the Missouri Tigers will be Jeff Jackie. Now you can run the ball back against Missouri. They're not very good at defending this. Opponents are averaging 26 yards each kickoff return against the Tigers. So watch for either Hudson or Charles Johnson to possibly break one right off the bat. Bit of a delay here as the officials discuss something in the middle of the field while the referee talks to Missouri head coach Bob Stull on the sideline. We should mention, harking back to last year's controversial game, J.C. Lauterbach was the referee in that game. He is no longer refereeing in the Big Eight or anywhere else because he has reached the mandatory retirement age in the conference, 57 years old. All the other officials from the game last year are back working Big Eight games. Right now, let's go down to the field. Mark McIntosh will be with us all day reporting from the sidelines. Mac?
Thank you very much, Les. You're talking about some Missouri wide receivers that will miss the ball game because of some injuries. Well, we found out just shortly, a little time ago, that Rico Smith, the Buff senior wide receiver, is very doubtful to play today. Rico has some tendonitis problems around his Achilles tendon, and I was talking to Dave Burton. He said it's very doubtful that Rico Smith will see action today for the Buffs. Back up to you guys.
Thanks, Mark. Dave, that's quite a blow because that is the Buffs' best deep threat.
Well, he gives them speed on the outside, but he has been hampered in practice for the last 10 days, so you would think that CU has had a chance to adjust to the loss of Rico Smith, and Charles Johnson more than likely will be the guy that will step in and fill his shoes.
You might even see Robbie James get into the game a bit with Smith out. James, the senior from Strasburg. And the Buffs might even go to Mark Henry a little more, their wingback.
You always get worried when you see the officials convene right in the middle of the field 5 minutes before the game should have started.
This almost feels like an instant replay delay.
This is something they absolutely don't need as you take a look at today's officials.
Your crew, headed by referee Larry Fisher, Ron Johnson the umpire, Hal Dowden, Ken Hopp, Terry Porter, Dwayne Osborne, and Artie Polk is the back judge. All right, the officials break as you see Bill McCartney in his 10th year here at CU, an overall record of 59 wins, 48 losses, and two ties. And this game today ties him with former coach Del Ward in the category of games coached at CU, 110 altogether. The only man still ahead of Bill McCartney is the former athletic director here at CU, Eddie Crowder. We are about to kick off at Folsom Field. Charles Johnson and Chris Hudson wait. The kick is deep. Hudson, no chance at it, and the Buffs will start with it at their own 20-yard line. Let's set the CU offense for you. The quarterback, of course, the senior, Darian Hagan. Behind him, a couple of young running backs, James Hill and Kent Call. Mark Henry is your wing back. Rico Smith will not be in the lineup today, and Sean Embry is the tight end. And the offensive line for the Buffs, Craig Anderson. Roger Ivey moves in for Clint Moore, whose play has been disappointing so far. Jay Lewenberg at center, Dolan Jackson and Jim Hansen. First and 10 from their own 20. Three men lined up behind Hagan in the backfield. And the pitch goes to Call, who gets about 4 yards. A host of Tigers in on the tackle, including the middle linebacker, Will Bass. The Missouri defense looks like this. John Watkins will move in for the injured Rick Lyle, Mario Johnson, George Hunt, Stacy Elliott in the 4-3 defense. The linebackers are Ken Gardner, Bass, and Reiner. And the defensive backs, Maurice Benson, a Jim Thorpe candidate, Jason Oliver, Brad Scrivener, and Sharon Washington. Second and 6 for the Buffs. Hagan takes it left side, has an opening, and a lot of room to run. And Hagan gets it up to the 45-yard line, his own 45, before he's run out of bounds by the safety, Scrivener.
Colorado came into the game trying to get involved in more option football and trying to test the perimeter of the Missouri defense. The first pitch went to Kent Call. This time, Hagan does an excellent job of stretching the defense, making those inside guys run. You see as Hagan eluded the first tackler, and you will see Colorado today offensively concentrate on pounding the football against this Missouri defense. Darian Hagan off to a good start. Missouri defensively is averaging, giving up 247 yards per game on the ground.
There are Hagan's stats for this year. And tack on another 10 yards, a penalty against Missouri. The run by Hagan went 21 yards for CU's all-time offensive leader in yardage. He passed Bobby Anderson on that all-time list a couple of weeks ago. Michael Westbrook in the game, lined up behind Hagan. LaBeouf's on the Missouri 45. That's Westbrook in motion. A good rush on Hagan. Penalty flags down. Hagan going deep. Overthrown, and the pass is broken up. Couple of flags on the field, and the call will go against the Buffs. Looks like holding.
No, I think they got Missouri offsides, Les.
Well, I saw the referee point the other way and give a holding signal. Let's see what he says. Well, we're both right.
Yeah. Hagan that time trying to elude the rush. I'm not certain if he was throwing this ball to Mark Henry. You see the offsides there as Mario Johnson got off a little bit too quickly. Hagan eludes the rush and then tries to make something happen downfield. Stacy Elliott with the pressure. But the bus called for holding, so they will line up and do it again.
The penalties negate each other. It's still first and 10 from the Missouri 45. Another good rush on Hagan. Tries to put a little juke on a man. Brought down at the 39-yard line. Call it a gain of 6.
And even senior quarterbacks can mentally make mistakes. That time Darian Hagan turned around and everybody was gone. Hagan just improvised, and that's one of his truly great assets. You see the all-time total offensive leader at the University of Colorado with over 4,500 yards.
Bill McCartney, 3 times the coach of the year in the Big 8. Well, it's not too bad when the play busts and you still get 6 yards out of it. Testament to Darian Hagan's quickness. It's 2nd and 5. The give goes to the fullback Hill. Breaks a couple tackles, gets it down to the 34. And he probably has the first down before Tom Reiner and Maurice Benson bring him down.
One of the qualities, obviously, of having a good option attack is you must run the football. You must run the ball inside with that fullback. Make the defense stop your inside running game. And James Hill, coming off a nagging injury to his ankle, able to pull away and gain the necessary yardage for the first down.
Well, those are not the dimensions of your conventional fullback, but James Hill has a way of shaking off the tacklers, and he did pick up the first down there. The Buffs with it at the Missouri 35. Hagan up the middle. Down to the 27. Will Bass and Kent Gardner the tackle. Let's go down to the sidelines and Mark McIntosh.
Thank you, Les. Some of you Buff fans out there watching the ball game might be curious as to why the Buffs are wearing black pants at home. Well, after that Stanford loss, Bill McCartney put them through 2 weeks of torturous practices, and it's a new beginning, the Big 8 season, and so they thought they'd come out with a new look, black on black. Back upstairs.
As some of the players called it Boulder Boot Camp the last 2 weeks. Senior defensive back Greg Thomas says it was the toughest stretch of practices he's experienced. Kent Call spins away from a couple tacklers. Finally gang tackle down at the 23. Washington and Scrivener there to do it.
Missouri playing their linebackers very, very deep in the 4-3. Take a look. They're 5 yards off the ball as they wait for the option. A good lead block by James Hill. And Kent Call, again, I think, at his best when he runs between the tackles. A slashing style of running. Call very, very strong and tough to tackle.
And I can hear the Missouri defensive coordinator saying to his kids right now, you got to wrap them up. They've missed quite a few tackles in this early going. 1st and 10 from the Missouri 23-yard line. CU showing a lot of wishbone formation today. The pitch goes to Call. He fumbles it and falls on it. Back at the 34, call it a loss of 10, maybe 11 yards even.
That's a look right at the line of scrimmage that Darian Hagan knows it's going to be a quick read. Jermaine Wilkins, one of the safeties on the line of scrimmage. So as a quarterback, you know that the option's going to be a quick one, and you're going to have to make a quick pitch. Hagen tried to get it out with both hands and simply tossed it behind Kent Culp.
Second and 21 for the Buffs. Hagen wants to throw. He does to Mark Henry, and the pass is caught at the 21. A gain of 14 yards.
Mark Henry has turned into one of the outstanding receivers for this Buff team. This will be just a comeback, and the good thing he does, gets under the football with his hands. The pass is going to be a little bit low, but Henry getting both hands, well, I tell you, that was a trap. The ball bounced into Mark Henry's chest, and Colorado looked like they got away with one there.
It's third and eight for the Buffs. Well, Henry comes from quite an athletic family. His sister, Mindy, is on basketball scholarship here at CU. Hagen has a man. Westbrook, touchdown. Michael Westbrook, the freshman out of Detroit, wide open in the end zone.
Colorado got Michael Westbrook on a linebacker. You see Tom Reiner, one of the inside linebackers, the 6'1", 240-pound senior. That is a mismatch trying to cover a kid like Michael Westbrook. Got the defense they wanted and a good touch pass by Hagen.
The extra point attempt by Harper is good. And the Buffs take an early 7-0 lead against Missouri. We've got 10:45 to go in the first quarter.
Because you believe these trucks shouldn't carry a spare tire.
It's a ride beer now.
Because up here, crisp-tasting beer just comes naturally.
It's a ride beer now.
Because when the whole gang gets together, there's no room for filling up. So reach for the silver bullet, the beer that won't weigh you down.
It's a ride beer now.
Tell you about my McDonald's. It's not just a place. It's a menu filled with good food for 59 cents anytime. Breakfast, lunch, dinner, snacks. Like, this is my McDonald's. And this is my McDonald's. And these are all my McDonald's. 59 anytime. And even though this was my McDonald's, your McDonald's is waiting for you with 59 anytime.
Tigers gambled early. They're in a man-to-man coverage. You see number 55, Darryl Major, the center of your screen, running to the running back. On the right side, Tom Reiner there is trying to cover Michael Westbrook's man-to-man. Nobody in the middle of the field to help Reiner, the linebacker. And the results, a touchdown pass from Darian Hagen to Michael Westbrook.
Mitch Berger kicking off for the Buffs. He has a tendency to put it out of the end zone and not allow the opponent to run it back. And running it back, or the attempt, will be made by number 22, Jason Oliver, and number 1, Skip Leach for Missouri. And there it is, as we predicted. Berger clear out of the end zone by a good 5 yards. Boy, what a weapon that is when you do it consistently. Penalty flag on the play.
Probably going to be offsides.
On the kicking team, 5 yards, free kick.
All right, so the penalty goes against the Buffs, and they'll kick it again.
5 yards.
Bring it back 5 yards to the 30. This shouldn't bother Mitch Berger much. He just put it 5 yards out of the end zone. And you can see for the year, Out of his 22 kickoffs, only 9 have been returned. It's a tremendous percentage. I've always wondered why you can't find more NFL kickers who can do that. Then again, not many NFL kickers play at this altitude.
And we move the ball back to the 30 for the kickoff. Kicking off, number 17, Mitch Berger.
Again, Jason Oliver and Skip Leach are back to return it. This time it's a clean kickoff, about 5 yards deep, and Leach will not return this one either. So Missouri will have 80 yards to go. And here's the Missouri offense. Phil Johnson, the leading passer in the Big 8. Ronnell Cahill, Kenneth Dunn, Skip Leach at flanker, Kenny Holly, and Lemmy Wills are the receivers. And the line, Doug Hembro, Mike Vidosky, Brad Funk, a 3-year starter at center, Don Wright, and Russ McCullough. A look at Phil Johnson. He's a sophomore out of Springfield, Missouri. He succeeds Kent Kiefer, who was a pretty good quarterback for Missouri last year, threw for more than 300 yards against the Buffs. Missouri comes out throwing. Maybe. Johnson turns the corner, picks up first down yardage, and goes out of bounds at the 31. Run out by Ronnie Wolford. The CU defense, you've got Leonard Renfro, the preseason All-American, Joel Steed at nose tackle, not wearing a cast on that broken hand anymore, Marcellus Elder. The linebackers are Chad Brown, Greg Beekert, John Knutson, the freshman, and Ronnie Wolford. And the defensive backs, Deion Figures, Ronnie Bradford, Eric Hamilton, and the senior co-captain, Greg Thomas. It's first and 10. The give went to Michael Washington, and he gets maybe a yard. A lot of black jerseys there to bring him down.
Missouri so far this year has had an excellent passing offense. They've averaged, as we mentioned, over 250 yards a game. And you can thank that man if you're a Missouri fan, Bob Stahl, in his third year coming in from UTEP. He's installed the pro-type offense. They have, however, had problems running the football. They've averaged only 2.5 yards per carry. And that's something that's going to have to improve if they're going to be successful in the Big 8 Conference.
The best passing team in conference, the worst rushing team. And it's 2nd and 9. Johnson rolls left. Takes off on this one also. Out of bounds at the 38. Call it a gain of 6. So far, the CU defensive backs, including Ronnie Bradford, who ran him out there, very good coverage.
And the last couple of plays indicative of what Phil Johnson can do. He has great speed, especially for a kid this big. He's 6'5 and over 200 pounds. And once things break down, he's not going to be nifty and make a lot of moves and make you miss, but he will outrun your perimeter defense, and he'll gain yards as he's doing it.
Tell you what kind of athletic prowess and what kind of body this kid has. His teammates call him Zeus. Anybody ever call you Zeus?
Not lately.
That's Washington. Gets maybe a yard. Well short of the first down, and Missouri will have to punt the ball. Back to return the kick for CU, Darian Hagan, and there's the man punting the ball, Mark Plunkett. He averages 39 yards a kick so far this year. That snap bounces in, but Plunkett fields it and then puts the ball well over Darian Hagan's head. Bounces into the end zone, a 63-yard kick. And the Buffs will have it at their own 20 when we get back from this break.
Pennzoil, at home in America, Charlotte, North Carolina, NASCAR, USA. This is where they build race cars and the engines that power them. And those engines, they don't come cheap. So what motor oil goes in this race car? The same straight-off-the-shelf Pennzoil quality that goes in your car. You know the one. Pennzoil. Ever since America learned to drive.
Get on, get on, get on.
Get on, excitement.
The all-new Pontiac Bonneville.
A new way to ride.
More than a work of art, an engineering masterpiece. With
the stability of four-wheel independent suspension and the accuracy of anti-lock brakes. The art of excitement, the science of control. The all-new Pontiac Bonneville.
Get on your Pontiac!
See your neighborhood Colorado Pontiac dealer.
Soundtrack celebrating 23 years in Colorado.
You can't beat Soundtrack's prices. Sale. And a huge selection of big-name brands. Sale. Not to mention helpful salespeople. Tell them about the sale. And let's not forget to tell everybody that everything in the store is on, markdown? Red tag. Attention, Soundtrack shoppers.
Hurry, Soundtrack's anniversary sale ends soon.
Les Shapiro and Dave Logan at Boulder's Folsom Field. You see the score right there. The Buffs off to a quick start. 7-0 over Missouri, and the Buffs have the ball right now. Darian Hagan, two-time All-Big Eight quarterback out of Los Angeles. And with that touchdown pass to Michael Westbrook, he broke a record here at CU. The previous record, six consecutive games with a touchdown pass. Hagan just did it for the seventh game in a row. First and 10 from the 20. Hagan slips, gets his bearing, and gets us to his tight end, Sean Brown. Up to the 37. Call it a gain of 17. Will Bass and Jason Oliver bring Brown down.
Colorado's been most effective this year when they've come out with play action on first down. Because Hagan slips, it throws off the timing of the pattern. And you'll notice Kit Call in the same area as Sean Brown. But Brown with excellent hands, he's the guy that Hagan likes to look to early in the game.
Hagan showing the balance reminiscent of a cousin of his, the NFL's all-time leading rusher, Walter Payton. Distant cousins, but cousins nonetheless. First and 10. Hagan tries to pitch it as he's fighting off a tackler. Probably not a prudent move, but the Buffs weren't hurt by it too much. The ball went out of bounds, and they will retain the ball. Putting the pressure on him was the outside linebacker, Tom Reiner.
Missouri defensively, they feel like will be improved this year, although statistically, it probably hasn't shown. But Reiner realizes it's going to be the option. He undercuts. He comes right through the lane, gets to Hagan as Darian tries to force the ball to Kent Call. Excellent play by Tom Reiner.
Are you surprised CU is showing so much option?
No, not at all. Missouri with the 4-3 defense, you're able to get to the corner, and they want to make sure those kids inside can run.
Second and 13, complete to Mark Henry on a crossing pattern. And Henry gets it up to his own 47-yard line. That'll be a first down.
And this is game plan wise. You see Brad Scribner out on Mark Henry, just a stop pattern, realizing the cushion of about 10 yards will enable Henry to catch it and then get upfield. Jason Oliver and Scribner both on the tackle, but offensively you take what the defense gives you. If they're going to line up and play your wide receivers and give them that kind of cushion, you have to throw the ball and force them to change that coverage.
And the measuring sticks are out, and you see CU gets the first down by about a foot and a half. Bill McCartney pacing the sideline. He's always nervous when he's playing his alma mater, Missouri. What is that? A fish. I hope the hat smells better than it looks. Hagan passing on the day so far is perfect. 4 for 4 for 64 yards. This time it goes to the fullback, James Hill. He grabs about 3 yards. Will Bass, the tackle. Well, we talked about the season series. Missouri leading it by a wide margin. However, up here in Boulder, when these two teams get together, it's even Steven. 13 wins, 13 losses, one tie. On the 50-yard line, the Buffs have the ball, 2nd and 7. Hagan on the run. The throw is wide, intended for Charles Johnson.
And there's a case where Darian Hagan, we've got an injured Missouri player, Hagan had Charles Johnson open. Westbrook in motion runs to the sideline. Charles Johnson just on a simple hook. The ball was thrown too far away. See Notre Dame in the second quarter leading Pittsburgh. Pittsburgh 5-0 this year, but the Fighting Irish had 14-0.
Well, so far you're proving me wrong in that game. I thought Pittsburgh would have a shot at Notre Dame, at least to beat the points. But Notre Dame right now doing a number on them. And the injured player on the field being carried off is a defensive lineman, Matt Murray. He's a freshman out of Carbondale, Illinois. Ironically, he majors in health-related professions. Let's take a look at how he got hurt.
To the left side of the screen, you can see Murray gets his right ankle rolled up on.
He's done for the day.
Turf is unforgiving.
Third and 7 for the Buffs. Once again, 3 running backs lined up behind Hagan. That's Westbrook in motion. Hagan looking downfield, throws a wobbler. Incomplete, and for the first time today, the Buffs will bring the punting unit onto the field. And their punter is the same man who kicks off. Number 17, Mitch Berger, who's averaging a bit over 41 yards a kick. Back to receive it for Missouri is Maurice Benson, who happens to average 18 yards a return, one of the best in the nation. He'll let this one fall, though, and Berger does not get the bounce he wanted. It goes through the end zone, and Missouri will have the ball at its own 20. A 50-yard kick for Berger. Well, he has really done a job for the Buffs this year. The latest in a long line of very fine CU punters. In fact, a punter from the past, an All-American, Barry Helton, is with the San Francisco 49ers this year. He's been injured all year. However, the 49ers are about to activate him. This telecast is an exclusive presentation of KCNC and the National Broadcasting Company and is intended solely for the private use of our audience. Any rebroadcast or retransmission of this telecast without the express written consent of KCNC is prohibited. Missouri tries to run the ball, but to no avail.
Boy, puts a lot of pressure on your quarterback when you just cannot establish even a semblance of a running game. Missouri, as we told you, unable so far in their previous 4 games to really get things going on the ground. They've relied on Phil Johnson and his arm and some timely turnovers by the defense to win games. But in this league, you have to run at least a little bit to keep people honest.
We're under the 7-minute mark in the first quarter. 2nd and 10. And that's Washington again. This time a loss of 2 yards. Chad Brown, this team's leading tackler, does it that time. Brown and Greg Beekert are both averaging 12 and a half tackles a game.
See Chad Brown with 31 tackles on the season, 19 assists. He had 17 tackles against Stanford a couple of weeks ago, and he's just starting now to feel more comfortable at outside linebacker. He's got the range and the speed, but until you line up there and you play a few plays, you don't get the knack of it.
He also leads the Buffs in sacks with 5.5 this year. Phil Johnson goes back into the shotgun now on 3rd and 12. And good pressure. Chad Brown almost has him. Johnson scampers up to about the 28-yard line, a gain of 10, but he's a couple of yards short of the first down. Joel Steen and Greg Thomas make the tackle.
Good pressure by the Colorado defense. You see Phil Johnson over talking to the coaches. They've got to find a way to protect the quarterback or get that running game going a bit. Can't be 3 downs and out all the time. You put too much pressure on your defense.
Mark Plunkett with a nice first kick today, 63 yards. He'll be kicking to Darian Hagan. Plunkett, another line drive. Hagan, a chance to return. Flags on the field as Hagan gets righted out on the 40-yard line. A 49-yard punt, an 18-yard return for Hagan. Dave, I don't know about you, but there is this black helicopter circling the stadium, and it's very low and making me very nervous.
Keep thinking of Black Sunday, don't you?
I saw that movie a couple of weeks ago.
During the return on the receiving team,
That's the movie where the terrorists rode the helicopter down into the Super Bowl stadium.
Let's not talk about that now.
Okay, I won't.
Take a look. There's multiple fouls. Eric Hamilton there, number six, on the right side of your screen. And also, that's probably a clip by Chris O'Donnell, number 45, as Hagan tried to break it to the outside.
All right, with 5:21 to go in the first quarter, the Buffs lead it 7-0. We'll be right back.
A McDonald's break.
Yeah, a Big Mac.
Fries.
Yeah, large fries.
An ice-cold medium Coke Classic.
Oh, give me a break.
Everything, all of it, right now, just $2.99.
$2.99 for all that?
Are we getting a break?
Yeah.
A Big Mac sandwich, large fries, and a medium Coke, all for just $2.99? That's incredible.
Nah, that's just one of the great value meals at McDonald's today.
Darian Hagan is sitting down for the time being on the punt return as he gets run out of bounds by Sharon Washington. He gets run right into the ground. It looks like he landed on his shoulder. And Vance Joseph is in the game for the Buffaloes. We'll give you a report on Darian Hagan as soon as one becomes available.
There's a look at Joseph on the year, 50% passer. This time he hands the ball off. Lamont Warren up to the 21. Maurice Benson brought him down.
There's Darian Hagan. You see Dave Burton, the trainer for the CU Bucks.
Well, I wonder with all the injuries the last couple years, if Hagan isn't sorry he chose a baseball career over football. He was quite a shortstop in college, or in high school, excuse me, and he was also drafted a couple times while in college, but never took any of the teams up on that offer. Vance Joseph calls a timeout on the field, the first timeout the Buffs have taken today. Joseph, the sophomore out of Marrero, Louisiana. He has gotten a lot of work. Last year, the Buffs had a lot of blowouts, and Vance Joseph saw action late in those games. And this year, with all the nagging injuries Hagan's had, Bill McCartney has put Vance Joseph into the game quite a bit.
I don't think Bill McCartney is very happy about that. The reason Colorado called timeout, they had 12 men in the formation. Mark Henry and Charles Johnson both in the game, and by the time Vance Joseph realized it, he had to call a timeout. Vance Joseph is a capable backup that I think really has a promising future in the next couple of years. He can throw the ball. He may not be at this stage of his career as explosive as Darian Hagan, but he can run the option. He makes good decisions, and I think he and Cordell Stewart certainly will have a battle the next couple of years to see who's the starting quarterback.
He's quite the athlete, just like Hagan. When he was 12 years old, he went to a world basketball tournament, and he was voted the most valuable player. Mr. Biddy World is what they call him. Joseph on the option. Brought down quickly. Gained a couple yards. Let's go down to the field and Mark McIntosh.
Thank you, Les. Here's an update on Darian Hagan on that punt return. He got hit in the nose. He kind of just got his bell rung. He's expected to be all right. We'll probably be back in at least on the next series for CU. Back up to you guys.
All right, so Vance Joseph taking charge of this team. If you're wondering, if anything happens to Vance Joseph, the Buffs can bring in a heralded freshman, also from Marrero, Louisiana, Cordell Stewart, a young man a lot of people say is the future of this Buffs program.
Ira- Ironically, last year in this very same game in Columbia, it was a second-team quarterback that led the CU Buffs to victory. Charles Johnson came off the bench, an 88-yard drive, a 15-play drive that, of course, resulted in the fifth-down scenario. But Hagan is back in the game. Vance Joseph returns to the sideline.
Well, the Buffs did get a first down on that last run by Joseph. So it'll be first and 10 from their own 23-yard line. 4.5 minutes to go, first quarter. The give to Lamont Warren. Not much room to wander. He's thrown for a loss of a couple of yards by Big Mario Johnson, 6'5", 310 pounds. I bet that hurts.
Mario Johnson was highly recruited by a number of schools, including Colorado. And for a while, the Buffs felt like they had a pretty good shot to get the young Johnson, but he has turned out to be a whale of a player for the Tigers.
I think whale is an appropriate word. They say he plays best at 285, and he's about 25 pounds heavier than that. I hope he doesn't get winded, I said that. Under 4 minutes to go. The Buffs lead at 7-0.
I hope he realizes it was you.
Hagan back in the ballgame now, throwing deep for Henry, but he is out of bounds. They say he was out of bounds before he caught the pass, not as he caught the pass.
Well, you can be out of bounds before you catch the pass as long as you are forced out by a defensive back. I'll tell you, Henry catches the ball and his left foot will come down in bounds. Mark Henry in the air, watch his left foot. Tough to see, it was in bounds, but the official ruled that Henry ran out of bounds. Jason Oliver on the coverage, and evidently Oliver did not force Henry out of bounds. Therefore, that negates the play.
So it'll be 3rd and 11 for the Buffs. We just got word from the Missouri bench that defensive end Matt Murray will not come back into the ballgame after spraining his right ankle. Well, the referee just confirmed what we told you a few seconds ago. It is 3rd down and 11 for the Buffs. And once again, Hagan is back at quarterback. This time, Lamont Warren to give. Across the 40 to midfield. A gain of 28 yards for Lamont Warren, the freshman out of Inglewood, California.
Now, Bill McCartney said he had a banged-up shoulder much of last week, but I tell you, this is a big-time run. Warren on 3rd and 11. Watch not only how many tackles he breaks, but the decisions he makes. There he cuts back. Good blocking up front. Now, this is supposed to be a tackle that stops Warren. That's Sharon Washington, one of the more sure tacklers on the Missouri club. But Warren, at 190 pounds, simply runs right through Washington and picks up the first down.
A lot of missed tackles for Missouri today. Hagan on the option again. It's the reverse to Westbrook. Evades one tackler. And evades about three more before finally going down at the Missouri 41. Michael Westbrook with some very good ad-libbing on that play. And he picks up 7 yards.
But Westbrook, we've seen before, has the capability of throwing the ball off this play, but this is a design run. Supposed to go around the end. Westbrook said, all right, I'll come back out there. Cuts back inside, and Westbrook at about 200 pounds was so tired after the play that he laid in the ground. And he's still tired, as you can see. He ran about 55 yards to pick up 7.
And he's in shape. Just think how we'd be looking after that play. 2nd and 3. The pitch back to Hagan. Looking deep. A wide open Charles Johnson at the 30. And finally out of bounds at the 29. A little tomfoolery from Bill McCartney.
When you establish the running game, obviously the defense has to play it, respect it. The drop, the lead, I should say, to Warren. You see the linebackers bite. Hagan trying to get the ball deep to Mark Henry on the go pattern, and Charles Johnson, the second receiver, comes all by himself across the field. He also will break the tackle. Scribner there has a chance, can't quite get him down. Let's pick up another first down.
14 yards on that last play. Got a timeout on the field. We've got another little tidbit from Mark McIntosh on the field. Mark?
Thank you very much, guys. You know, you saw that fancy pass that went to Charles Johnson. Well, this week, they worked on that play extensively in practice. But Bill McCartney always told us to turn off your cameras when they're working on that. That's one of the trick plays they put in for this ballgame to try to surprise the Missouri Tigers. Back up to you guys.
Well, Mark, as an objective reporter, you're supposed to tell us those things are coming.
Well, he made us turn off the cameras.
I understand that. Timeout on the field was called by Missouri, the Tigers' first timeout. Each team has two left this half. We've got 2:20 to go in the first quarter. A look at the Missouri sideline. The Tigers down 7-0 to the Buffs. You know, we've talked so much about the fifth down controversy from last year, Dave. Really, when the game clock starts running on this Saturday, nobody really thinks about last year, do they?
Well, the players don't. I think fans probably will remember that particular game for the next 10 to 15 years. They'll be talking about that game when you and I and everybody else will be long gone.
Well, the Broncos may be taking the week off, but Channel 4 and NBC Sports will still be here tomorrow to bring you the best in NFL football. At 11 a.m., the Browns and the Redskins. And at 2 o'clock, Miami and the Kansas City Chiefs. It starts tomorrow morning at 10:30 right here on Channel 4. Hagan left side on the option. Flag down on the field before Hagan goes out of bounds at the 12.
I think this is going to come back because Mark Henry, number 25, who was in motion, I believe, turned up the field too soon.
Well, you're absolutely right. A procedure call against the Buffs.
Boy, costly mistake there. Henry and wingback in motion toward the formation side. Just turned up to get the block before Hagan had the ball in his hands.
Procedure, not enough men on the line on the offense. Repeat, first down, 5 yards.
They actually called not enough men on the line. Bill McCartney not happy with that.
Well, so far, total yardage, CU dominating this ballgame. 157 yards, Missouri with a paltry 25 yards. However, the game is still very close, a one touchdown difference. First and 15 for the Buffs from the Mizzou 34. Hagan, a little dump pass taken in by Lamont Warren. A nice move, picks up a few extra yards. Down to the Missouri 27. John Watkins finally brings him down.
And really, in recent years, you haven't seen Colorado get their tailback involved too much in the passing game. With Eric Bieniemy and J.J. Flanagan so proficient in running the football, Hagan just a little dunk pass over the middle, and watch the move by Lamont Warren. Whoop. Couple go by, and he picks up an additional 5 or 6 yards. Those are the kinds of moves that you just simply can't teach. Here's a kid that was in high school last year that obviously has mastered at least a few of them.
And he was a quarterback in high school. 2nd and 8, Hagan. A wild pitch. Let's see how it's called. Out of bounds. CU will keep it because Missouri could not get a handle before it went out of bounds. Jason Oliver, the closest Tiger to it, couldn't gather it in.
Well, Missouri is doing a better job defensively at taking on the blocks at the line of scrimmage and stringing out the play. Now, this is a pitch that Darian Hagan simply cannot make. He lost his footing and tried to pitch it on his way down. And you can see Maurice Benson did everything but corral the football. Must have touched it 3 or 4 times.
Most teams that play CU stick one man on Darian Hagan, the quarterback. They say, you keep your eyes on that young number 3, and wherever he goes, you go. But so far, the majority of the first quarter, Missouri has had trouble stymieing Darian Hagan, doing a much better job in this last series, however. 1st and 10 for the Buffs on Missouri 18. One wide out for CU. Top of your screen is Charles Johnson. The give goes to call, a big hole down to the 10-yard line. A gain of 8.
The Buff offensive line doing a good job of getting a push, and they have worked on this extensively this week. Lewenberg, Ivy. You see Anderson, Dolan Jackson, number 74.
And a good look at Kent Call, the true freshman out of Fort Morgan, Colorado. coached by his dad, Rich, in high school. It's second and two. We've got 45 seconds to go in the first quarter. This is Call again, and another big hole, and another 5 yards. He picks up the first down, so it'll be first and goal for the Buffs. CU with a 1-touchdown lead. Very close to making it 2 touchdowns. Michael Westbrook comes into the game for Mark Henry. 3 backs behind Darian Hagan. James Hill, the fullback, gets in. He pulls his way in for the touchdown. That was too easy, Dave.
And that too, a play that they had just put in for the Missouri game. Lined up in the power bone. Hill, the fullback. You see the action to the left side, but Hill will cut back to the right. Sean Brown with a good job of running down the defensive end. And James Hill met at the 2-yard line by Sharon Washington, just not going to be denied.
Hill, the sophomore out of Whitefield High School in Colorado Springs. Jim Harper, the extra point. He's got it. And the Buffs have a 14-0 lead with 25 seconds to go in the first quarter. Well, this is what you like to see at homecoming. You usually make homecoming a game on the schedule you think you can win. And the Buffs certainly think they can win this one. They actually need to win this one because next week might be their toughest game on the conference schedule. They go to Norman, Oklahoma to play the Sooners.
It's going to be one of their toughest, if not the toughest. And aside from just winning the game, I think Colorado has to regain some of their confidence that obviously was lost in Palo Alto, California a couple of weeks ago. Bill McCartney was just not happy with a number of things, and most importantly, you as a team have to believe you can win every time out. James Hill, the fullback, to the right side. The blocking goes down. You see the Tigers in a stunt. Excellent job up front again. Good job that time by Jim Hansen, the right tackle, and James Hill into the end zone. And now offensively for Missouri, I think important in this series to get something going, even if they don't put points on the board. They have been completely stymied by the CU defense, and that's the strength of the Missouri team, their offense.
Mitch Berger putting the ball on the tee and back to receive the kickoff from Missouri. Jason Oliver is number 22 on the right side of your screen, and on the left is Skip Leach. They're pretty good at this task. Jason Oliver, 19 yards per return, and Skip Leach averages 22 yards. But so far, they haven't had a chance because Mitch Berger has put it well over their heads all afternoon. This one's a bit short for Berger. Jason Oliver takes it at its own 5. Oh, Chris Hudson grabbed the jersey and brought him down. I'll tell you what, if Hudson didn't do that, you're looking at another 10, 15 yards for Oliver. Instead, Missouri will start with it at its own 24-yard line. Chris Hudson has really done a job for the Buffs this year. He's a freshman redshirt out of Houston. He's playing so well that in the last couple weeks, head coach Bill McCartney has considered putting him into the starting lineup instead of co-captain Greg Thomas, the senior. Hudson gets a lot of game time. Phil Johnson still at quarterback for Mizzou. The give goes to Ronnell Cahill. And he gets a couple of yards before Chad Brown does the number on him. Well, we're coming down to the end of the first quarter. The teams will allow the clock to run out. 1 second. Zeros reading on the scoreboard. And we're going to take a break here with the Buffs leading after one quarter, 14-0.
The blueprint.
What's the architect?
Jose.
Fine.
Sell.
Fine. Short the market.
The power.
power to put it all behind you. To kiss all the stress, all the stomach-churning headaches of business goodbye. That's the power of United. That's the power of the friendly skies.
Budgeting is financial stability. If you don't know where your money's going, you don't know what you have. Call CCCS. They can help you.
Today's game is brought to you by First Federal Bank, by State Farm Insurance, and by Samsonite. All proud companies for Colorado. And also by Coors Light, by Taco Bell, and by Racket World.
Les Shapiro and Dave Logan at Folsom Field in Boulder. You see the score right there. The Buffs leading by 14. What a great day for football. Hardly any wind. A lot of sun. Very few clouds. It ought to stay this way the rest of the afternoon. And Missouri has the ball right now. Look at James Hill on the CU sideline. Scored the last touchdown for the Buffs. Missouri with second and nine. Johnson is back in the shotgun, with four wide receivers lined up on the line. That pass incomplete. Beaker, good coverage on number 81, Kenny Halley. Here are your first quarter stats.
And you take a look at him, Missouri with one first down and 26 yards of total offense. None of them coming with the passing game. Buffs, of course, with 106 yards of rushing, 85 in the passing game for 191 total. They have completely dominated both sides of the line of scrimmage here in the early going, and their defensive backs have been able to take away those wide receivers. As we've said, Missouri without Victor Bailey, maybe their best wide receiver, but so far nobody has really come open. Byron Chamberlain also did not make the trip. He's their tight end who plays like a wide receiver.
Mark McIntosh has something for us on the sideline. Mark.
Thank you very much, Les. You might be able to see right now, Jay Lewenberg, the Buffs starting center, senior co-captain, is having his blood sugar checked. Buff fans might know that Jay Lewenberg is a diabetic. He has to take two insulin shots per day to control the diabetes. And right now, he's having that blood sugar level checked. Five team physicians, if they find out there's a problem with that, they'll try to take corrective action to take care of it. But it looks like he'll probably come back in the ballgame. But he was feeling a little woozy when he came off the field after the Buffs touchdown series, and they're checking that blood sugar level right now. Back up to you guys.
You also might have noticed that his right hand is wrapped up. In fact, it is a cast, because 3 weeks ago, Lewenberg broke his right hand, the hand he snaps the ball with, in practice. However, he has not missed a game. Against Stanford 2 weeks ago, he snapped with his left hand, and now he's back to snapping with the right.
See the time of possession. That's what happens when you can run the football. And conversely, Missouri, with a little over 4 minutes of possession time, they haven't been able to run it. And actually, Phil Johnson, the last play, attempted Missouri's first pass of the afternoon. He's gone back a couple of times, but he's had to pull it down and run.
I want to go back to something you said a couple minutes ago about Missouri with 0 yards passing. That's quite a mean feat by the CU defense, because the Tigers average 251 yards a game in the air, and zero in the first quarter here. Third and nine. Johnson in the shotgun again. Good pressure. Johnson on the run. Finally gets it off. Incomplete. The intended receiver was Holly, but three black shirts chasing Johnson to the sideline, making him throw off balance. It was Leonard Renfro, Ronnie Wolfork, two of the three.
And that time, Colorado really putting pressure on Phil Johnson with a four-man rush. Missouri not doing a good job up front. If you give Phil Johnson time, he can throw the ball. But very difficult when running to your left to pick up that much yardage.
Well, the Buffs are going to try something different today. Chris Hudson is returning punts for the first time all year. Gathers it in at his own 34 and has a hole up the middle. An open highway. Inside the Missouri 35, Chris Hudson.
One of the luxuries of having a defensive back as your punt returner, if he can catch the ball, they usually have more strength than a wide receiver or a running back that might return punts. You see Hudson shirk away from the first tackler, and he's got good broken field running ability. Brings that one back 33 yards, and the Buffs are in business again.
His first punt return all year for 33 yards. We also have a change at center for the Buffs. It's Erez Gottlieb in for Jay Lewinberg. This is Hagan with a little room inside the Missouri 25. Penalty flag down. Maurice Benson, the tackle for Missouri. There's a look at Benson. The penalty might be on him.
It's going to be a face mask right at the end of the tackle.
Inadvertent face mask, 5 yards from the end of the run, first down.
Take a look at it. Hagan into the secondary will get grabbed right there.
It's Will Bass who grabbed the face mask. Right at the end of the tackle. So Tech on 5 more yards. And the Buffs have the ball at the Missouri 18. Lamont Warren inside the 15, down to the 14, gain of 4. Boy, the Buffs are really blowing holes in that Missouri defensive line now.
Well, I know Bob Stoll was concerned about his defense holding up against the CU offense. Although CU certainly has not set the world on fire, they are big and strong up front, and you knew after 2 weeks of Bill McCartney's type practices, they'd come in ready to play. The disappointing thing for that man has been his offense. They haven't been able to generate anything. Forget the points, not even yardage.
Second and 6 for the Buffs. This is James Hill with a lot of room inside the 5. Boy, there is not a Tiger within 5 yards of these running backs. Sharon Washington finally makes the tackle. The Buffs threatening to turn this one into a blowout.
This play designed to go inside. Look at the nice cut. Again, Missouri stunning up front. You can see Stacy Elliott get knocked down inside. A good block that time by Craig Anderson. Hill realizes the stunt, bounces it to the outside, and as you mentioned, there weren't any white jerseys anywhere to be found.
Almost 4.5 yards a carry for Hill this year. Pretty good when you consider he's a fullback. And those guys are used to just punching out 1 and 2 yards at a time. Well, this play will be stopped. About 17 linemen jumped at each other before the snap.
Dead ball, encroachment on the offense, 5 yards, repeat the down.
Bill McCartney with a bit of a look of worry on his face, but if the Buffs can get in here, this is a 3-touchdown lead. Mark McIntosh, you got something for us.
Yeah, a slight update on Jay Lewinberg. We had told you earlier his blood sugar level was being checked. He's also dehydrated. And there's a concern on the Buffs sideline right now. A lot of their players are getting dehydrated in this heat, and they're asking for more water. They got to keep the liquids in their players. It's a hot afternoon down here on this artificial turf. Back up to you guys.
Well, it certainly is. It's in the low 80s in the stands. You can imagine it's about 5 or 10 degrees hotter on the turf. And these kids aren't used to this in the fall in Boulder, Colorado. We're going to take a break. 12:53 to go in the first half. The Buffs with a 14-0 lead and threatening.
For years, you've depended on State Farm to insure your home.
Daddy!
But did you know you can also depend on us to provide financial security for those you love? State Farm. We sell life insurance.
Be sure to contact your Denver metro area State Farm agent soon for a free family insurance checkup.
It's Oktoberfest at your Jeep and Eagle dealers. Yes, you could don an attractive short outfit, but we think you'd look better in a new Eagle Talon at this great price. Or a new Jeep Cherokee with cashback and Olympic discounts. You could buy this, but it's easier to fit your family into this. A new Summit wagon with air conditioning at no extra charge. Don't miss the Jeep and Eagle Oktoberfest, where you'll say, skip the Wiener Schnitzel, Hilda. I want a new car.
See your local Jeep Eagle dealer.
Little visit.
cheerleading squad. I feel a flip coming. No, just a straight letdown. But no letdown on the field. The Buffs up 14-0 on the Missouri 8-yard line. Hagan, nowhere to run, nowhere to hide, and run out of bounds at the 7. Call it a gain of 1.
Quarterback Barry Hagan on the carry.
Colorado this year has been inside their opponent's 20-yard line 13 times. They have scored 13 times. They've done a good job taking care of the football, realizing how important every possession is. See, that's a lot of water right there.
If Jay Lewenberg is dehydrated, he ought to move on over there.
Good night.
Enough water to keep him going.
She's working harder than some of the guys in the field.
Second and goal from the 8-yard line. Hagan wants to throw. And now he wants to run, and now he wants to throw again. Incomplete, broken up by Jason Oliver. And another flag on the field. Darian Hagan had a bit of a problem making up his mind there.
I think he may have gone past the initial line of scrimmage. Once you do, you can't come back and throw it. Got a man downfield. And that can easily happen when your quarterback looks like he's going to run, then all of a sudden pulls it up and lets it go.
Well, you are on every call today, aren't you? You're right there with
the Zebras. Line of scrimmage is about the 8-yard line. Hagan.
Ineligible downfield, 5 yards, repeat the down.
Now, Hagan really wasn't past the line of scrimmage, but they did have a man downfield.
Can you step over the line of scrimmage and then come back behind it and pass the ball?
No.
Once you're over, you're over.
Yeah.
You've got to run with the ball.
As I just said, once you pass that line of scrimmage, you've got to keep going, although he didn't that particular play.
Second and 13 for the Buffs from the 13. That ball is tipped, almost intercepted. Looks like Mario Johnson, the big guy, 6'5", might have gotten a hand on it. From Florissant, Missouri.
In years past, this would have been an ideal situation for the tailback screen. Eric Bieniemy got behind all those big offensive linemen, caught the ball, and they couldn't find him for about 20 yards.
Well, they're lining up Lamont Warren just like Bieniemy used to. One running back behind Hagan, and he will get the ball. And a lot of room. Inside the 5, down to the 4. But still short of the goal line, and it's 4th down for the Buffs. The crowd wants the Buffs to go for it. But this is probably the smart move. The field goal kicking team comes out.
And Jay Lewenberg runs without his helmet. He is going to snap the ball.
Jim Harper with the attempt. A 22-yard attempt. He is 2 for 5 on the season so far. Field goal kicking. And this one is right through the uprights. So the Buffs with a 17-0 lead right now. Jim Harper evens his record to 3-6 on the year. I should say a 50% record now. With 11:51 to go in the half. The Buffs by 17 points. Sunday nights are your sports nights here on Channel 4. Immediately following the News 4 Late Edition at 10:35, it's the Bill McCartney Show featuring the coach himself, along with our color analyst today himself, Dave Logan. They'll bring you all the highlights and analysis of today's game. Then it's Sports Extra with Gary Miller, where you'll hear KOA Radio's Sandy Clough's expert analysis of the Broncos, plus an introduction to a couple of high school coaches that have been coaching together for the past 25 years. It all starts at 10:35 this Sunday, following the News 4 Late Edition. McCartney, and then Sports Extra. Did I say Sandy Clough on KOA? I mean Sandy Clough on KBIG. He used to be with KOA. Hard to tell in these radio wars.
We all bounce around.
You used to be with KBIG. You're now with KOA.
Yes, I am.
Kind of a one-for-one trade there.
You could look at it that
Logan
way.
Logan for Clough. Any future considerations on either side of that? Back to receive the kickoff from Missouri, Jason Oliver and Skip Leach. And this sails well over Skip Leach's head. I'll bet that really takes the gas out of the team, knowing they will rarely get a chance to.
I tell you what, the guys that have to run down and cover those things, they love it. They are the kicker's best friends. Buy him dinner, do whatever, take him to a movie, do whatever it takes to have him kick that way. And now, as we've mentioned, if Bob Stoll had some firecrackers, he might place them under the fannies of his offensive team. Time to get things going, if you're a Tiger fan.
The onus is on Phil Johnson, the Tigers quarterback. So far, struggling. This time, he has time. He had a wide-open receiver, but the ball was tipped by, I believe, linebacker Ronnie Wolford.
Well, Lemmy Wells is going to come clean across the field, and I think it was Chad Brown who made the great play. He got sucked inside by the play action, but had enough presence to back up, jump in the air, and tip the ball away from a wide-open tight end. And Phil Johnson's got to be scratching his head.
Well, that Chad Brown play brings back memories of last year's game against Notre Dame. 10 tackles, 2 deflected passes, and a forced fumble. And a 10-9 win in the Orange Bowl. Phil Johnson, 2nd and 10. Over the middle, in between 2 receivers, the ball bounces. I think Johnson might have had a bit of a time trying to figure out which one to go to and went in between them.
And Kenny Holly and Skip Leach, 2 crossing patterns. What I see, Missouri receivers running and trying to look to see where the defensive backs are as well. Missouri's running a lot of crossing patterns, and as a receiver, you know that from time to time, when you catch one of those, you're going to get blasted.
Third and 10, the crowd picking up the decibel level. Flag on the field.
Didn't get it off in time, I don't think.
Dead ball, delay on the offense, 5 yards, repeat the down.
So push Missouri back another 5 yards. It'll be 3rd and 15 from their own 15.
The Colorado this year coming into the game, their opponents had faced 3rd and 9 or more 26 times and had converted into first downs none of those 26 times. They are 0 for 26, and Missouri's been in that situation a few times here today, and they haven't converted as well.
And you can bring the house at them now. Watch for CU to blitz, knowing full well Missouri needs to pass the ball. In fact, Johnson goes back into the shotgun. Good pressure. The screen pass is complete to Cahill, but he is nowhere near first down yardage, and Missouri will have to punt again. Joel Steed, the tackle on Cahill.
Pretty good call, the screen pass, and Cahill with a nice catch. But how many nose guards do you know that can run down running backs? As Joel Steed just did that time. And CU defensively, I think, so far, they've been the story of the game.
Darian Hagan back in to return the punt for the Buffs after getting a respite. Hagan will field it at his 24. Reverses field and gets it up to the 31. A punt of 53 yards and a return of about 7. 17-0. The Buffs lead Missouri. 10:56 to go in the half. If the game seems like it's going a little slow, it's because with Missouri passing the ball as much as it does, the clock stops after each incompletion. And there have been plenty incompletions today on Missouri's side. 1st and 10 for the Buffs at their own 30-yard line. Hagan across the 40. A wild pitch. Boy, he's done that 3 times today. Somebody's going to talk to him on the sideline next time he ambles over. And flags on the field. Well after the play, 3 different officials threw the yellow flag into the air.
I think it may have been a forward pitch. That's what we'll find out here.
Have an illegal forward pass thrown forward beyond the line of scrimmage. 5 yards, loss of down from the spot of the pass.
Remember a couple of years ago when Darian Hagan in Norman, Oklahoma made a great pitch almost falling flat on his face. And it resulted in a touchdown for Colorado. After you do something like that, especially early in your career, you have a tendency to try to do things all the time like that. And Hagan has made a couple of ill-advised pitches here this afternoon that, frankly, he's been very lucky Missouri did not recover. That time, looking for the home run play after a lengthy gain, it was a forward pitch, and CU has to line up, but they also lose it down.
So instead of first down and a big gain, it's second and two. Hagan overthrows Charles Johnson. Johnson, the sophomore out of San Bernardino. Also a trackster here at CU. Darian Hagan not very happy with himself. These kids are happy. Their Buffs are up 17-0. It's a great day.
Hey, you suck. Get out of here. Yeah,
there's no school. Doesn't get any better than that. Third and two. This is call. Stopped at the 40. Picks up first down yardage.
Oh, I don't know.
It'll be close. Shouldn't have spoken too soon. In fact, it doesn't look like the mark is going to go in the Buff's favor. He might be about a half foot short.
Yeah, I think a great defensive play that time by the Tigers. His call looked like he was going to amble past that 40-yard line. He got necktied and thrown back.
I did speak a little too soon. CU brings the punting unit on. Mitch Berger, the punter, and Maurice Benson will return. Ten minutes to go in the first half. Berger gets one off, end over end, a nice angle, and it goes out of bounds at the 10.5-yard line. Quite a kick by Berger. He's got to be happy with that one. 50 yards and no return. And Missouri is pinned back at its own 10. Boy, they've been staring at 80 and 90 yards downfield all day.
Kicking games can mean so much to defensive teams. If your kickoff team puts the opponent in the hole, you've got a lot of territory to work with. And conversely, if your punt team can do what Mitch Berger did just there,
pretty strange.
Intensity-wise, really emotionally gets you back into that game and turns it up a notch or two.
Well, the Broncos found that out against Houston last week, didn't they? A blocked punt and a blocked field goal. And Houston annihilated it as a result. Missouri has little success running it as they've had passing it. Cahill stopped for a gain of one. Bill Johnson has had some pretty good games this year. 297 yards passing against Illinois, 296 yards passing against a very tough Baylor team. Second and nine. Johnson nowhere near the intended receiver, Kenny Holland. Again, good pressure from the Buffs, and you could tell Johnson heard the footsteps from Joel Steed. Joel Steed coming off a concussion last week that he suffered at practice. Looks like his head is on straight this week.
You know how hard practice was when your nose guard gets a concussion? Joel Steed, about 280 pounds. You don't want to see him get knocked down too much. See, Miami.
Is that right? Second quarter?
No, it's a fourth quarter score now. Miami leads Penn State 26-20. Pretty good game.
Third and nine for the Tigers. They'll run the ball, but not very far. Cahill brought down by Chad Brown and Greg Beaker, the Buffs' leading tacklers. And once again, Missouri will punt. Well, it looked like that time, Dave, they just gave up. They said, we've got a long way to go. We're not going to make it. We'll run it up the middle and get rid of the ball.
Well, they had Colorado in a nickel defense, and what they tried to do was spring Cahill through the middle, hoping that they'd get some man-to-man coverage and he might be able to pick up the first down, but didn't work.
Mark Plunkett having to punt from his own end zone. Hagan will receive. A nice punt by Plunkett. Hagan at his own 36. And gets it up to his own 48. There's a penalty flag down. A 49-yard kick. And about a 12-yard return. Oh, the call's going to go against the Buffs.
Actually, why don't you go ahead and go?
Boy, Hagan was really hit hard at the end of that run back. But he's staying on the field, and he'll quarterback.
Cliff, during the return, 15 yards from the end of the run. First down.
That pushes the ball back to the 33-yard line. And we're going to take a break at Folsom Field. Bill McCartney pointing out that his Buffs lead 17-0.
Arnold Palmer at home in America.
1929, that was the year I was born. The tractor, well, that came along a little later. And Pennzoil, well, that goes back to my dad. That was his motor oil. I'll tell you, you couldn't be around him long without learning the value of keeping the equipment running. And you know, everything around here is still working.
Pennzoil, ever since America learned to drive.
How do you take Buick LeSabre, the American car renowned for worry-free driving, and make it better? First, you make it longer and roomier. You make it aerodynamically smoother. You add a driver's side airbag and anti-lock brakes to make it safer. Plus, four-speed electronic transmission to make it quieter. Introducing the all-new 1992 Buick LeSabre. America's best-selling full-sized car just got better. See it now at your Better Buick dealer.
A little trombone music on homecoming day. Colorado leading the Tigers of Mizzou 17-0. 8:27 to go in the first half. Buffs have the ball on their own 33. Just received a punt. So it's first down. Two wideouts in there for the Buffs. Mark Henry on the top part of your screen and Charles Johnson below. And Hagan runs the option to call. Hit by three Tigers, spins away up to the 39-yard line, a gain of six. Kent Call so far this year with 186 yards rushing. He averages 4.2 yards a carry, and he's the Buffs' leading scorer with four touchdowns this year.
Take a look, Darian Hagan makes this work. There's the pitch man. You see the penetration by the defensive end. That's John Watkins, and Call, once he turns upfield, once he squares the shoulders, it's fairly difficult to knock off his feet.
There's something unusual. Sean Brown, the tight end, lined up wide right. Doesn't matter. They go up the middle to James Hill. John Watkins once again on the tackle. And Hill gets the first down for the Buffs. Hill's running very well this year despite a chronic ankle problem. Well, you could hardly tell. Tough young man. First and 10 from their own 44. This is Call. With some fine blocking, gets it across midfield, down to the Mizzou 47. Darrell Major, the linebacker from St. Louis, the tackle.
Well, we just talked about James Hill, the fullback. Don't watch the ball this time. Watch the fullback. Watch number 33 as he leads Kent Call right through the hole. Bam! Now, that's Call knocking folks down as James Hill got in the legs of Tom Reiner, the linebacker. And that's what you have to have. You got to have a fullback that will knock people down, knock them off their feet. And James Hill, an excellent blocker.
Second and one for the Buffs. Hagan gets the first down inside the 45. Sharon Washington, the free safety, makes the tackle. He's Missouri's leading tackler with 13 and a half a game. Has good genes. His dad, Benny Washington, played for the Houston Oilers.
Well, he's going to get to know Darian Hagan quite well here this afternoon. Most times in option football, the free safety is assigned to the quarterback. Not in every scheme, but in a lot of them. And that time, Sharon Washington saved a big game.
Buffs running at will. Big chunks of yardage. It's first and 10 from the Mizzou 44. This is call again. This time, he can't get away from Washington. Brought down right around the line of scrimmage. Here's a score from around the big eight. Nebraska playing at Oklahoma State, and the Huskers with a quick start, 14-0 lead in the first quarter. A few other games around the big eight today. Kansas is at Kansas State. They're hitting the rivalry early in the schedule this year. And Oklahoma is at Texas. Iowa State has the weekend off. 5:37 to go. Buffs with a second and 9. Hagan goes deep. Complete. To Robbie James, who we felt would get a lot of playing time today, with Rico Smith not in the ball game because of an ankle injury.
I'll tell you, this thing had to be right on the money, because Robbie James, with Jason Oliver very close to him, there's not a lot of room to fit this football in. James, the comeback. Look at the coverage by Oliver. Pretty good. Nice throw by Darian Hagan, and Robbie James got both feet in bounds.
And they had to stop the game and give him the ball, because in 3 years here, Robbie James has not caught a pass. That's his first reception as a CU Buff. And it gives the Buffs a first down from the 32. James Hill, head down across the 30. Brought down by Maurice Benson, who felt the brunt of Hill's helmet. Also on the tackle, Travis McDonald. Frustrated Missouri Tiger team, down 17-0. Less than 5 minutes to go in the half. Second and 5 for CU. Hagan keeps. You know what I never understood, Dave? Why do you run the option to the short side of the field? What's the reason?
Because more times than not, defensively, you will have that extra man to the wide side, expecting a team to run the option to the wide side. And you can sometimes outnumber your opponent by taking that option weak side.
My point is, it always looks so congested. If you're not running into one of the defenders, you're running into one of your own men.
Well, obviously, it's tough to make the pitch to the short side, but you can sometimes squeeze that quarterback into that lane and get big yards.
Well, we measured for the first down, and the Buffs have it. On the Missouri 21-yard line.
Quite probably, with the senior quarterback, Darian Hagan audibilizes quite a bit at the line of scrimmage. More than likely realized that Missouri was going to be outmanned weak side and changed that last play.
Buffs with a new look, two running backs. Hagan on play action. Complete to a wide open Charles Johnson at the 10-yard line, and he's gang tackled. He's thrown back a couple of yards, but he'll get a pretty good placement. Down almost to the 10-yard line.
Two nice adjustments here. Watch Darian Hagan step back inside and buy himself some time. This move right there enables him to throw the ball. Charles Johnson, instead of running all the way across the field, stopped, hooked up, and found himself the opening for Darian Hagan to find him.
That's CJ's second reception on the day. Sophomore out of San Bernardino. The scoreboard looking a little odd. First and 10 from the 11. Hagan, wide open, touchdown, Sean Brown.
John Brown lined up right side of the screen. The play action off the option will allow the linebackers, or allow Brown to get behind the linebackers. And again, that's what happens when you're so successful running the football. Defenses have to react to what they see initially, and they got sucked up inside.
The extra point by Harper is good. And the Buffs looking like a rout in progress, 24 to nothing over Mizzou. Shapiro and Dave Logan, 4:03 to go in the first half. The Buffs with a very comfortable lead over the Missouri Tigers, 24 to nothing. Mitch Berger kicking off. And Jerome Madison fields the pop-up, but there will not be a return. That last scoring drive went 10 plays, 67 yards for CU. They add up almost 4.5 minutes, culminating in a Darian Hagan to Sean Brown touchdown pass. That's the second touchdown pass Sean Brown has caught this year. A look at Bob Stull in his third year at Mizzou. He's got a record of 8-17-1. About to become, it looks like, 8-18-1. Johnson, the dump off pass to Ronnell Cahill. First down yardage across the 30 to about the 33. Ronnie Bradford ran him down along with Ted Johnson. Ted Johnson in the last couple weeks in practice actually earned the start in a middle linebacker spot. But he had a family member die and he went back home for the funeral. So John Knutson retained the starting spot, the freshman out of Great Falls, Montana. But Ted Johnson getting a lot of work today. First down from their own 32. Johnson falls back into the shotgun. Again, they dump it off to Cahill. Missouri going to the short passing game. Fumble. There's a pile. And the officials quickly call it still Missouri ball. And they're across midfield. It's their furthest penetration into CU territory all day.
Well-designed play again in the shotgun. Cahill counts 1 second, 2 second. Drift to the outside. The ball will pop loose, and it looked like Dion Figures, number two, had a great shot at it. Just had to go right past it. And Kenny Hotley, I think, came away with the recovery.
Well, Missouri with a little momentum now. Let's see how far they can take it. The first time all day in CU territory at the Buffs' 49-yard line. Pressure. Johnson gets it off incomplete. The pressure came from Johnson, the linebacker. And a yellow flag down.
Ronnie Wolfer got there about a second too soon. That's going to be pass interference.
Pass interference on the defense, 15 yards, automatic first down.
Boy, you are just amazing today. I think you've had every call correct.
Well, I tell you, that's an obvious call. Ronnie Wolfork, it's tough to hold up as a linebacker once you draw a bead on a receiver. and you're going to go get him. If anything happens to throw the timing of the play off a little bit, you're usually caught, and in that case, caught with the yellow flag.
Boy, the linebackers hate that, don't they? They want to defend against that run all day long and butt helmets, and when you make them cover a guy coming out of the backfield, it's not their forte, at least not most linebackers. They'd rather play the rock'em sock'em game than have to handle a guy who runs a 4.5 40 to their 4.8. First and 10 still for Missouri from the Buffs 47. Michael Washington gets it back to about the line of scrimmage. Chad Brown, the junior, with the tackle.
See, that's where you need that running game. You're moving the ball a little bit. Nice short passing game. You put a screen in there, that works. And then you need to pop that play for 7 or 8 yards to keep generating the momentum for the offense. But you come up now 2nd and 10, and you're back in the hole.
Less than 2.5 minutes to go, first half. Good pressure again. Johnson on the run. Not a good pass. Incomplete. Greg Thomas thought he had the interception. The official thought the ball bounced off the turf into his hands. I'd like to get another look at that one.
Colorado doing a better job that time of disguising the blitz. They will bring 7 men after Phil Johnson. And Johnson, again, with terrific mobility, eludes the rush. Well, I think that may have been a valid catch. Tough to see from that angle. Phil Johnson picks up a low snap, realizes that he's got problems. There's Greg Beekert and also Eric Hamilton, number 6 from the free safety spot. The pass away, going to be impossible to see from that angle. Third down, the Tigers.
Yeah, Eric Hamilton is the man who made Missouri botch that play with the pressure he put on Johnson. This time Johnson intended to run and does. Inside the 45. Call it a gain of 3, but it'll be 4th down for Mizzou. Greg Beekert the tackle. Let's see what the Tigers do here. Good chance they'll go for it.
Well, I'll tell you, 4th and 6 or 4th and 8.
I think it's right in between. I think it's 4th and 7.
You give up field position here, and Colorado goes down and scores, you're pretty much out of the game. This is, in my mind, a big gamble if they go for it by Bob Stull.
Well, what do you have to lose, Dave? You're down 24-0.
Well, you got plenty to lose. If you go down 31-0 at halftime and give up a score like this, a cheap score at midfield, I think you lose the kids. You punt the ball, you're down 24-0. Now, if they succeed here, of course, he looks like a genius. But I think you got plenty to lose here. You're 24-0 down, and that at least keeps you in sight, although they haven't played very well.
Well, it looks like Missouri will not go for it. They took a delay of game penalty. And right now, there's nobody on the field for Missouri. And they do bring on the punting unit.
See, I know Missouri fans are going to question this, but I think this is the correct call by Bob Stull. It's not 4th and 1 or 4th and 2. It's 4th and 7. And you're virtually at midfield. You miss it here and give Colorado a short field to work with and 1:30 to go, you're out of the game.
Missouri took its time making that decision. The 5 yards being pushed back does not hurt them as a result of the penalty. Plunkett, the punter, is in. Hagan is back to receive it for CU, back at his own 10-yard line.
And although different circumstances, just ask Hayden Fry about going for it late in the first half. A fake punt on 4th and 9. Michigan stops them. They go down and score. And from that point on, it was all Michigan in Iowa City.
Plunkett booms it into the end zone. A punt of 51 yards. And the Buffs will have 1:09 to work with, starting with it at their own 20-yard line. CU leading 24-0. Another sellout here at Folsom Field. Every game this year sold out except for the Kansas game in early November. So if you want a chance to see the Buffs, the black and gold, how they look this year, and you don't want to watch it on TV, there are still a few tickets up for grabs here for the game against Kansas. Darian Hagan, a quarterback for the Buffs. And the Buffs are going for blood. Deep to Eric Mitchell, the speedster. Just out of his reach at the 25-yard line. Hagan really had a whip on that ball. Eric Mitchell, possibly the fastest man on this team. He runs under a 4-3 40.
Darian Hagan made up his mind he was going to let this thing go. Now watch where it takes off. About the 17, 18-yard line, and it lands at about the 18-yard line. Wow. That's 64 yards in the air.
That's right. 101 to go. This time the Buffs stay conservative, go up the middle to James Hill. And he gets four and a half yards.
Bill McCartney had said Darian Hagan's arm looked like the life would come back to it this week. I would say based on that throw, he's right.
Third and six.
It'll be third and six. 30 seconds left in the first half. A very nice first half for the Buffs. Hagan escapes one tackler, hits the sideline across midfield. If he can get by a couple men here, he's in, down at the 40-yard line. With 10 seconds to go, do they run one more play, try to get it in the field goal position?
Well, I would call timeout. The clock will be stopped as they move the yard markers. Colorado's called timeout. Hagan just eludes Stacy Elliott in the backfield, and then this is just his God-given ability. Darian Hagan makes a nice cut back inside, runs out of gas a little bit right here, and I think also realizes that the clock was going to run down. But you've got time for another play. You want to try to get, obviously, a few more yards toward the end zone. Colorado, by the way, does not have any more timeouts. So with that in mind, if you're going to run another play, it has to be toward the boundary on either side to get out of bounds.
Well, if you're wondering, Jim Harper, the Buffs field goal specialist, has a long kick of 50 yards this year. Right now they're at the 41-yard line of Mizzou.
You knew he was going to be a great player when you first saw him as a freshman here in Boulder from Locke High School in Los Angeles. He just had that extra something that great option quarterbacks all seem to have.
All right, let's see how the Buffs work it. Eating up a lot of time right here. Hagan almost intercepted by Brad Scribner with 2 seconds left.
In that case, Colorado lucky the ball was knocked down, because had it been caught, time would have expired in the first half.
Yeah, but it's a black mark on Hagan's record. I think he'd rather go without the interception. Mitch Berger will attempt a field goal. Harper normally kicks it, but this one is very, very long. 48, it's at the 48-yard line. It's about a 65-yard attempt. And well short. So at the half, the Buffs with a 24-0 lead over Missouri on homecoming day. The Buffs go off the field with a number of high fives. The beginning of the conference schedule, and it's a very fine beginning so far. One half against Missouri has quickly wiped out any remembrance of the fifth down controversy last year. Missouri feeling it should have won that game. The Buffs telling him right now, no shot today. Let's go down to the field and Mark McIntosh.
And kept him alive. And thank you, Les. We're going to listen in on Coach Stoll's comments.
He's moved the ball. We only had one first down until that last drive. What is Colorado doing defensively that's giving you all the trouble?
Well, we're just not executing very well. We had some breakdowns, and we're just not getting any yardage on the running game at all and not executing the pass very well.
You're not running as much. Is that because Michael and Ronell are somewhat banged up?
Well, they're banged up, but, you know, we haven't gotten more than three plays at a time until that last drive. So, you know, when it's second and 10, you know, you're more out to throw than you are to run.
All right, thanks a lot, Bob.
Coach Bob Stuhl of the Missouri Tigers, his team struggling offensively here in the first half. They trail it 24-0. Last backup.
Thanks, Mark. The CU marching band immediately takes the field. It's 100th year of performing at halftime the CU football games. We're going to take a break. We'll be right back at Folsom.
How do you take Buick LeSabre, the American car renowned for worry-free driving, and make it better? First, you make it longer and roomier. You make it aerodynamically smoother. You add a driver's side airbag and anti-lock brakes to make it safer. Plus, four-speed electronic transmission to make it quieter. Introducing the all-new 1992 Buick LeSabre. America's best-selling full-sized car just got better. See it now at your Better Buick dealer.
Arrogant.
Haven't seen a place this classy since I left the Bronx.
Greedy.
Whoever has the most when he dies wins. It's the American way.
Self-centered.
We haven't talked about what I want to talk about.
What's that?
You and me sweating between satin sheets.
Danny DeVito.
I take from the rich and I give to the middle class. Well, the upper middle class. Would you care for some caviar?
Other people's money.
Has a nice ring to it.
Rated R. Starts Friday, October 18th at a theater near you.
If you added up all the potato chips you've eaten during poker nights and playoff games, you'd end up with some serious spuds. But you still wouldn't have a taste as big as these little Gino's pizza rolls. Ooh, a tremendous taste of zesty pizza and a hot little bite-sized snack. A taste so big, it makes ordinary chips seem like small potatoes. Gino's pizza rolls, the pizza way to snack.
Les Shapiro and Dave Logan at halftime. The Buffs lead at 24-0, and I think Bob Stuhl summed it up pretty well. When you know the pass is coming on every down, it's easy to defense.
Well, Missouri has not been able to establish any kind of running game at all. They've averaged about 95 yards per game running the ball previously, but when you can't run at all, it puts a lot of pressure on your offensive line, your quarterback, and your receivers. And Colorado, I think the most impressive thing about their performance here in the first half, defensively, they have answered the challenge against a pretty good output.
Other side of the ball, we knew CU would be able to move it because Missouri has possibly the worst defense in the Big Eight. They're giving up 495 yards a game, and they're right on schedule to do that again today.
Well, I think Colorado came out, established the running game early. They've mixed a lot of play-action passes. Hagan has thrown the ball successfully, and Bill McCartney's got to be thrilled at halftime.
All right, we'll be back in a couple minutes. We'll talk about first half stats. We'll show some highlights from that first half also.
There's something new. You're gonna love it. From KFC, it's called the Gold Bucket. Pick any kind, just $5.99. At KFC, it's Go Bucket time.
KFC introduces $5.99 Go Buckets. Enjoy original recipe, hot wings, or extra tasty crispy chicken. Choose any one for just $5.99.
Nobody's cooking like today's KFC.
Nobody's cooking
like today's KFC.
Nobody.
It's one of those perfect fall afternoons. The air is crisp. The leaves are turning and winter is most assuredly on its way. And this is the perfect spot to watch it all. The perfect sofa, too. Leather, of course. It's so comfortable and affordable. Right now at Howard Lorton, all fine leather furnishings are on sale. Yes, the perfect sofa. Leather on sale only at Howard Lorton. Colorado's leader in quality home furnishings and interior design.
John's a great partner. He wants to do the best of whatever he does.
Good afternoon, General with Toyota.
Rod's always been number one in this business. That's why I'm partners with him.
They're extremely helpful. I felt that everybody was really friendly.
I want our customers to know that they can count on me, that we'll be here for them, now and down the road.
Very friendly and courteous and willing to bend over backwards to help. I know I'll come back to John Elway.
Honest value and good service. That's what it's all about.
John Elway Toyota. It's a whole new buying experience.
What's up?
The talking elephants our sales force left with yesterday?
Yeah, there's been a little problem. Do we have any that speak elephant?
Mm-hmm. So who's going to get them to all of our salesmen?
One company offers 10:30 delivery to more places than anyone and treats them all with mammoth importance.
Presenting Hugo, the talking elephant.
Federal Express, our most important package is yours.
There's your score at halftime. Let's go down to the field now. Mark McIntosh with a special person to talk about.
Thank you very much, Les. You know, with a 24-0 lead at halftime, it takes some of the luster off of the revenge factor from last year's fifth down game. And if you look back on last year's game, one name certainly stands out, and that's Charles Johnson, who, of course, quarterbacked the Buffs down the stretch, who ran that quarterback sneak for that controversial touchdown of the Buffs' victory. Well, Charles Johnson decided to give up football this year, but as you'll find out right now, Charles Johnson is staying real busy. It was 9 months ago. Charles Johnson led Colorado to its first national championship, picked up the Orange Bowl MVP trophy, then walked away from the game, despite having a year's eligibility left. He quit while on top, and with no regrets.
It's going fine. You know, I have more time to not only study and concentrate on school, but to relax. Let's give myself a break.
But Johnson hasn't completely turned his back on the game. Beneath the roar of jet airplanes landing at Stapleton, he's coaching the Lions, an Aurora youth football team. It's a bunch of 12 and 13-year-olds just getting their feet wet in the world of gridiron warfare.
Well, buddy, just a long way from 81,000 in the Orange Bowl.
Hey, yeah, it's just exciting, man. These kids out here, they play hard, and you know, it's satisfying. Just as satisfying as coming out behind Ralphie.
Give me a right pro Adam Street. Fake 24 Adam Street. Right pro, fake 24 Adam Street. You go in for Isaac.
I've learned the value of having a coach like him and the value of playing football with a team, on a team, with a team, you know, being a part of a team, you know, and helping the team out, winning. That's what it's all about.
Well, there's two things that I want to get across to you. One is the technical side of football, how to do things right, line up right, play hard. Two is to love to win. Learn and love to win, but understand that it's valuable lessons in losing. And we all are going to lose at some point. And the difference between losing and being a loser is those who can take a losing experience and make something positive.
B. Go 5 yards, the guy's at 10 yards. You just ran right into him. Knucklehead.
Johnson quit football because it was too time-consuming. School's very important. He wants to attend law school next year. And then what? Down the road 5 years. What lies ahead, CJ?
Yeah, I think about it all the time. I can't make any sense of it, though. Hopefully, I'll be doing what I plan to do.
Which is?
Practicing law. Trying to help. No people.
Politics in the future?
Yeah. Possibly.
But for now, Charles Johnson's worried about getting the Lions straightened out. They've lost two of their first three games, and his thoughts also drift back to his old team, the Buffs, who are struggling themselves right now, and getting ready for Missouri, 1 year after number four played such a big role in the infamous fifth down fiasco.
You know, you knew you were going to miss it. How much have you missed it?
About as much as I had anticipated. I figured I'd miss it. It would be tough. It's not overwhelming, though. You know, I hadn't second-guessed my decision or anything, except for this Missouri game. This one would be tough for me to sit out.
Charles Johnson is sitting out the Missouri game, but he is here in person on the sidelines. And, CJ, what do you think of the first half?
Looks good. A lot better than a year ago.
you've had a lot happen to you in the past year. Just recently, I guess you're out in L.A. Tell me about that.
Well, I was out for Roy Firestone's Up Close show, aired on ESPN earlier this week.
Roy Firestone, what'd you guys talk about?
Well, surprisingly, we didn't even talk about athletics, really. We talked about current events, issues, that world issues, really.
Also, I understand NBC's Real Life with Jane Pauley has gotten a hold of Charles Johnson here recently.
Well, yeah, you know, I don't want to make this thing seem like it's something that it's not. It's, yeah, they contacted me, and apparently they want me to come out and do some things with them as well.
Why do you think everybody is so interested in the Charles Johnson story?
I can't figure it out, Mark. I can't figure it out. But, you know, I felt like it just gives me an opportunity to express myself, and whatever comes of it comes of it.
You know, these last 2 weeks for the Buffs were very difficult. Mac basically put them through a boot camp-like atmosphere, and they've responded today.
That's right. It's been difficult for me, too. I mean, it's hard to see my teammates, and they're still my teammates, go through the things that they've gone through so far this season. But with a little adversity, you're mature enough and strong enough to come through, good things are the result.
I know you're still very close with a lot of guys on the team. Have they talked to you at all about what they thought might be some problems with the 2-2 start?
Well, yeah, I mean, basically, there's really no real answer to that. They realize that they have to, though, and that's just come together. And I mean, regardless of what the outcome is, game week after week, they have to get strong and get better.
CJ, thanks a lot, buddy.
Thank you, Mark.
Charles Johnson, former quarterback of the CU Buffs. He's got that number one ring on his finger. He's taken off. Matter of fact, he's going to coach his little league football team, the Lions. They got a ball game right now, so CJ is heading out of the stadium as we speak. Les, back up to you.
Thanks, Mark. It's nice to see the young man Charles Johnson doing as well, if not better, off the field as he did on the field. We'll be right back. Halftime at Folsom Field.
The KG Men's Store birthday sale is here, featuring our entire stock of suits and sport coats at 2-for-sale prices. For example, save $200 on handsome Johnny Carson wool blend suits. Get two for just $2.99. Hager sport coats, originally $125 each, now two for $159. Hurry to the KG Men's Store birthday sale. Great clothes don't have to be expensive.
We were at Shelley's Grill and Bar for lunch, surveying the menu. Well, they had lots to choose from, but the chicken was just too tempting.
Hey, come here. Cluck, cluck, cluck.
A grilled marinated chicken breast, served over a bed of rice with fresh steamed vegetables. That chicken platter was just what the doctor ordered. Everything was great. And the whole staff really bent over backwards for us.
It's Oktoberfest at your Jeep and Eagle dealers. Yes, you could don an attractive short outfit, but we think you'd look better in a new Eagle Talon at this great price. Or a new Jeep Cherokee with cash back and Olympic discounts. You could buy this, but it's easier to fit your family into this. A new Summit wagon with air conditioning at no extra charge. Don't miss the Jeep and Eagle Oktoberfest, where you'll say, skip the Wiener Schnitzel, Hilda. I want a new car.
See your local Jeep Eagle dealer.
My house? It's got to be cozy. Close to work. And I don't plan to spend my weekends gardening.
If we could buy a house today, oh, it's gonna be us.
Someday I'm gonna have a house with a bedroom for everyone. And space just for me.
Let a real estate professional show you how HUD Homes can make owning easier and more affordable than you ever dreamed possible.
Well, the CU band, including the alumni band, providing the halftime entertainment here in Boulder. Dave Logan eating a hot dog. The Buffs lead it 24-0. And we'll return for more halftime activities from Boulder after these words and a message from the University of Colorado.
Samsonite's Adventure Series luggage is perfect for those active vacations. It's sporty, easy to carry, and like every Samsonite, quite durable. The Adventure Series, for all you can pack into a vacation.
just like magic. Chesterland Chevrolet, for a limited time, will offer you the chance to buy a new 91 Chevy or Geo for a low 91 price. Prices like $59.99 for a 92 Metro. That's a 91 price for a 92 Geo. Here's the new 92 Chevy truck, just $69.99. There's only one thing wrong with a sale like this. Prices like these don't last forever. So if you'd like to get in on a good thing before the magic of this sale is over, head on over to Chesterland Chevrolet, the affordable way at I-25 and a Boulder exit.
The age of information. As a parent, you know the early years are the most critical time in your child's development. That's why News 4 and Minute Maid are pleased to present Over the Rainbow, the region's largest parenting festival. Come to the Children's Museum, and inside you'll find everything from where to bronze your baby shoes to entertainment and workshops. Over the Rainbow, a colorful world of fact and fantasy for your family.
Broncos fans, join the tailgate party on Sunday. Half-price admission with your game ticket. Bring the whole family.
Do you know a special teacher who's making a difference in your school? Write News 4 and then watch A-Plus for Teachers every Tuesday at 4 and 6:30 only on News 4.
Today's game is brought to you by Grease Monkey, a proud company for Colorado. And also by Subway Shops, by Kinko's, by Coors, by the Denver area Honda dealers, and by Farmers Insurance.
Colorado's a great place to live and study.
Okay, let's hit the Mesa Trail.
A lot of us like to go run in the mountains real early in the morning. I think that the University of Colorado is committed to the students. I like the fact that the teachers are real easy to get a hold of and they're so willing to help.
Well, we've talked about the problems.
I wouldn't be here if I couldn't have an impact on my undergraduates. We have an excellent group of teachers here.
They have so much energy and want to pass that on to their students.
I think it's really important that the university recognizes the quality of life here. Things like smaller classes, easy access to the professors.
You know, I've always felt that the professors are there for me. And that's the way it should be. That's the way it is at the University of Colorado.
All right.
Some of the things that make the CU campus so attractive to so many students, about 25,000 students. Halftime at CU, the Buffs lead it 24-0. Go Tigers. Well, they haven't gone very far so far. We'll take a look at stats in a second. Right now we're waiting for the Buffs and Ralphie to come back onto the field. Some first half highlights of this 24-0 game.
Well, Colorado offensively got off to a great start. Here, the first touchdown of the game, Darian Hagan to Michael Westbrook. Westbrook on man-to-man coverage finds the open seam. They came back. They've dominated the game. Here's James Hill going for the second CU score. But Darian Hagan once again off the play action. The option game really changes what you try to do defensively. You got to get a lot of bodies involved in stopping the running game, and when you do, Sean Brown is able to slip behind you for the touchdown catch.
Look at how dominant CU is.
I think the one stat that Bill McCartney would like to see the most, maybe a couple, but certainly 228 yards rushing. Colorado had just not been able to get into the running game in the first four games, not the way McCartney wanted. Plus, you look at the total yards given up by the CU defense, 71. And that's against a fair to Midland Missouri offense. This is not an offense that rivals Florida State or Miami, but it's certainly better than some of the teams CU will face this year.
I'll tell you how bad it is for Mizzou. Not just 72 yards total offense, but they haven't even had a chance to return a punt or a kickoff as much as CU has kicked off this afternoon. They're not getting anywhere. And it's quite a turnaround from 2 weeks ago when, against Stanford, CU gave up 100 yards plus rushing to two different Cardinal runners, Milburn and Vardell. So the 2 weeks of tough practice have gone well for CU and translated to a very fine afternoon here on defense.
Keep in mind, if you're Bob Stahl, aside from telling your club what you think of their performance in the first half, you want to stress to Missouri that Colorado has been in front at halftime in all four games. And obviously, they surrendered that lead in two of the four. So Missouri, on this first possession, wants to get something going offensively. The strength of their team, they can go down and score and get it into the end zone. See a couple of guys are at least excited to have a chance to catch it. Maybe they turn things around.
That was Jason Oliver and Skip Leach trying to charge each other up. They'll be receiving the kickoff for Mitch Berger. Oliver, about 8 yards deep, does the prudent thing. Knee goes down. Berger with another good kickoff.
Once again, Missouri starts from 20 list, their best field position so far.
Bob Stowe with a few more gray hairs after that first half. It's going to take a while to build this program back. It's been down for a few years now. Phil Johnson, the quarterback from Missouri. He'll come out winging it. Ronnell Cahill. That brought the U's and ahs from the crowd.
You'll see Cahill on the right side of your screen trying to block Chad Brown. Well, you won't see it. What you will see is Cahill getting decked by Ronnie Bradford. A zone defense. Cahill runs right to the corner, and there awaits Mr. Bradford.
Bradford out of Adams City High School in Commerce City, a sociology major. Second and seven for Mizzou. Johnson with some time finds Skip Leach across midfield down to the Buffs 45-yard line. A flag is down. Phil Johnson with a nice fake right off the snap, bought himself some time and found Skip Leach downfield. 33-yard gain.
Completed pass, inadvertent face mask, 5 yards from the end of the run, first down.
I think Colorado defensively lined up improperly here. Skip Leach, we can't see him, but Deion Figures is man-to-man on the wide side of the field with no help and gave Leach about 10 yards. Leach took him to the post, then back to the flag. That's a very difficult route to cover when you give up that much room.
An inadvertent face mask penalty, just 5 yards, as opposed to an intentional face mask, which would be more yardage. First and 10 for Missouri on the CU 40-yard line. Johnson, complete. A nice catch by Kenny Holly. Went high in the air to grab that one. And he is inside the Buffs 30.
We've talked about Phil Johnson and his arm. Little play action fake. Sets up tall in the pocket. Rifles the ball in. Holly makes a nice catch, and Missouri is doing exactly what they had to do.
Dangerous pass. Second half. Excuse me, Dave. Dangerous pass. Three Buffs surrounding Kenny Holly. And a nice acrobatic catch. First and 10 at the Buffs 28. This is Washington. Down to the 26. Beekert and Chad Brown, the two linebackers, make the stop. Bob Stahl, the Missouri head coach, says to get this program back on its feet, he wants to pass the ball for a number of reasons. Number one, a lot of Big 8 teams aren't used to defending against the pass, not very well anyway. And passing the ball is attractive to recruits. You got to get the recruits in if you want to build the program back. And then once the program is built back, get a few top-notch running backs, and you're back on top. Good pressure. Complete to Cahill. The pressure came from Leonard Renfro, but Johnson was still able to get the pass off. And Missouri looking a little more charged up here, Dave.
Good pressure by the CU defense. Johnson does a nice job of just realizing he's got someone in his face. His back is to Renfro. Gets the pass off. That's actually Joel Steed. That is Renfro. A nice catch by Cahill, and Eric Hamilton realizes he's got that coverage from the middle of the field, the free safety. On the blitz, he's got the back out of the backfield and got a good running start.
Third and six, Missouri has three wide receivers lined up to the left of quarterback Phil Johnson. And one on top of your screen, so four wideouts. And he dumps the ball off to Cahill. Good defensive play by Greg Thomas to bring up a fourth down situation for Mizzou.
Boy, Mike Badowski, the offensive right tackle, left guard, had a chance to block Thomas. Had he got the block, that was going to go for big yardage. But a good job by Greg Thomas on the screen.
And for the first time all day, we're going to see Missouri attempt a field goal. Jeff Jackie in the ballgame. He is perfect on the year. He's 3 for 3. And this attempt will be 44 yards. It's long enough, but it's wide left. Jeff Jackie and Mizzou missed the field goal attempt, so CU preserves the shutout. It's still 24 to nothing early in the second half. Mizzou's best shot so far today at putting some points on the board. Let's go down to the field right now. Something from Mark McIntosh.
Yeah, thanks, Les. You noticed the bus came out with a lot of intensity there in the second half. At halftime, McCartney said, "Hey, guys, I want you to act like it's nothing to nothing. Keep it up." He was very happy with the first half play, but he wants to see the same intensity, and so far we've seen it. Back up to you guys.
Well, it's the same quarterback in for the Buffs. Darian Hagan gives to the first man through James Hill, and Hill gets it up to the 31. Call it a gain of 4.
We've got a huge upset in college football. We'll show you in just a minute. That's not it. Miami beats Penn State 26-20.
First and 10 for the Buffs. Hagan keeps it, then pitches. That time, good timing on the pitch, a clean pitch. And Lamont Warren gets it up to the 44-yard line.
Well, Hagan's got a little evil Knievel in him. And we've seen it over the years. Stretches the defense. You run to the perimeter as far as you can. Just as you're going down, he takes the ball in his right hand and flings it toward Lamont Warren. And that results in a big play. As a freshman, you just keep running. Stretch that defense, and you'll get the pitch eventually from that guy.
I think by the time his career is over here, Hagan's going to have as many broken bones as Evel Knievel, too. First down from their own 45. Hagan again. This time keeps it all the way. And a penalty flag on the play. Hagan got it inside the Missouri 45.
I don't think that'll be an inadvertent face mask. I think that might be the big one.
I'm still waiting to find out.
Hagan again stretches the defense. You'll see the face mask. This time it's used to make the tackle. That is only an inadvertent call. Travis McDonald, 200-pound freshman linebacker, with the face mask.
Looks fairly intentional to me. I'm still waiting to hear about this upset.
We'll tell you right after this play.
Okay. I don't know if I can wait that long. First and 10 at the Missouri 39. Lamont Warren again. Finds a little room to the outside, inside the 35-yard line. Call it a gain of 5.
All right, here you go. How about this one for an upset? And a team that's familiar in these parts. Rice beats the number 8 ranked team in the country, the Baylor Bears, 20-17. That might be, after the year is done, the biggest upset in college football this year.
In Waco, Texas, Baylor, in the top 10 this week, beat Mizzou, beat CU, was undefeated coming into this weekend play. Second and five for the Buffs. The pitch to Warren. Can he get it outside? Yes. One man to beat. Driven down at the six-yard line. Lamont Warren showing a few moves. Not bad for a freshman. Maurice Benson finally makes the tackle. A 28-yard run.
Well, Lamont Warren, again, gives you the swivel hip, the quick pitch. Warren there. Now watch him make a couple of Tigers miss. Just runs right through the arm tackles. And a 190-pound freshman is having himself quite a day. In option football, sometimes you're going to be able to defense it, but you just can't make the tackle. That time, Missouri in perfect position, but unable to bring him down.
So the Buffs with a first and goal from the six-yard line. James Hill gets it. The fullback inside the five. Gain of two. Bob Stoll very, very worried right now. A score here could put this game out of reach for the Tigers. It's 24 to nothing CU. Under 9 minutes to go in the third quarter. Well, this is what you don't want to see if you're Missouri in your conference opener, because it can make for a very long conference schedule from here on out. Hagan wants to do it himself. Doesn't get the blocking, however, and he's thrown for a couple yard loss. Maurice Benson right there has been a very busy man today, because he's the man who is keying on Hagan, and Hagan's been keeping the ball quite a bit. In fact, in the first half, Hagan alone had 92 yards rushing. So it's third and goal from the seven. Hagan into the end zone. Oh, off the hands of his receiver. Sean Emery, the tight end out of Cherry Creek High School. I think that ball was tipped before it ever got to Emery.
You never know as a receiver when he's running around back there exactly as to where he's throwing the ball. The ball was deflected right at the goal line. It looked like Travis McDonald may have got his right hand on it. Emery just couldn't react quick enough.
Missouri takes a timeout here. This is a very key series for them. They have got to keep CU out of the end zone, or you'll be looking at a 31-0 lead. We'll be right back.
Subway, Belzger Wharf, and they think good sandwich. We don't deep fry or freeze dry. Everything's fresh. Each morning, I slice tomatoes, onions. I even bake the bread. These days, people think a lot about what food to eat. Nothing's more honest than a good sandwich. So if the body's a temple, this is the place to come when a temple gets hungry.
For some of the best sandwiches anywhere, visit the Subway near you.
After 5 p.m., buy any regular footlong and soda and get the second footlong for 99 cents.
CU lining up for a field goal. This is a 24-yard attempt by Jim Harper. Mark Henry on the hold. And the kick is good. So So CU ups its lead to 27-0. Little by little, chiseling away at the Missouri Tigers. Crowd enjoying this one. It's homecoming at halftime. We were introduced to the homecoming king and queen and their courts. The Missouri Tigers trying to get their act together. Here's your score from South Bend, Indiana. Notre Dame doing a number on the Pitt Panthers, 35-7. They're in the fourth quarter. And Nebraska putting the hurt on Oklahoma State in Stillwater, 21-3, the Huskers, and they're only in the second quarter. The other Big Eight game has Oklahoma at Texas today. Oklahoma, of course, in the Big Eight. Texas in the Southwest Conference. And Oklahoma leads that one 7-0 in Dallas. Some other local teams in action today. Air Force is at Navy. CSU has the day off. And Wyoming is hosting Utah. Jerome Madison and Skip Leach will field the kickoff from Berger. Well, no, they won't, because that one, once again, went out of the end zone. 8:25 to go in the third quarter here at Folsom. The Buffs lead it 27-0. A lot of the fans finding this a good time to go to the concession stand. The game seems to be well in hand. Phil Johnson struggling today. He is 8 for 14 for 85 yards. Most of those yards have come here in the third quarter. Crossing pattern intercepted. The Buffs intercept. That's Ted Johnson, the freshman out of Vista, California. A great one-handed grab.
Well, you talk about an outstanding play by a freshman. The inside linebacker first has to read the run. Then after he determines it's a pass, he'll get depth. Number 46, the right side of your screen, sticks his left hand out. That's a play you don't see made many times at any level. Ted Johnson with a great interception. Got into the passing lane, read the quarterback's eyes, but the thing about this, look at the catch. That's a catch receivers don't make often.
CU making a change at quarterback. Vance Joseph is back in the game for Darian Hagan. The Buffs with the ball at the Mizzou 27. The pitch to Warren. He's wrestled to the ground at the 29, a loss of 2 yards. Darryl Major with a major tackle.
I think Darian Hagan's okay. You want to get your second team quarterback as much playing time as you can, quality playing time. You see Air Force ahead of Navy 17-6 in the third. Because in option football, your quarterback takes a lot of shots, and Hagan's been banged up much of the year. This man right here might be the guy down the stretch that is called upon at a crucial time.
The give to Warren. Turns the corner. And run out of bounds at the Missouri 12-yard line. That's a first down. Brad Scribner gave him a push outside the white line.
You'll find a lot of freshmen that come into college football with great physical abilities, but few that I've seen have the ability to set people up and be patient as he runs. He's such a smooth runner, and that time did an excellent job of darting in and out behind blockers. You don't see that a lot from 18-year-olds.
First down at the Missouri 12-yard line. The Buffs trying to put the Tigers away here. Looks like a mix-up on the play. Joseph keeps it. Gets a few yards out of it. Inside the 10. Down to the 7. Call it a gain of 5.
Vance Joseph's walking back to the huddle saying, hey, he changed the play at the line of scrimmage. All right, I'll handle it to... Hey! He changed the play, and everybody must have not heard him, because Vance turned around and handed to nobody. Decided to keep it and picked up some yards.
And we're told Joseph is in the game because Darian Hagan is getting a rest. Plain and simple. Buffs have two players who have gone over the 100-yard mark today rushing. Hagan has 101, and Lamont Warren has 112. Second and five. This is Warren again. Pulls his way down to the 2-yard line. Flag on the field.
Holding on the offense.
Take a look at the left side of your screen. Roger Ivy at left guard gets a handful of jersey that time. I think he's blocking Mario Johnson, and that's where the flag came in.
Roger Ivy, the senior out of Loveland, Ohio, one of two Buffs married. So it'll be second down for the Buffs. And when they have two players rushing for 100 yards plus, like Lamont Warren and Darian Hagan have today, the Buffs are undefeated. Second and 13. Joseph keeps it. He'll be in. CU touchdown.
Well, speed is nice in the option, but quickness is essential. And you'll see Vance Joseph ride that fullback. He realizes right there he's got to keep the ball. And look at the quickness he exhibits getting into that end zone. He dropped the football, and initially I thought he was well into the end zone, but that was close.
The extra point by Harper is good, and the Buffs have themselves a 34-0 lead. We'll be right back at Folsom.
Between you and me, this is my best value at $22,000.
The price of today's automobile is higher than ever before.
I can get you into a 48-month payment plan, no problem.
The terms of financing are longer than ever before.
Let's go into my office.
That's why regular oil and lubrication maintenance every 90 days at Grease Monkey is more important than ever before.
21.5. What do you say?
Grease Monkey, extending the life of your car.
We could go 60 months on the payment.
Presentation.
We're ready.
When your department has to deliver, call Kinko's, the copy center. We take care of the copies so you can take care of business. Now you can get the highest quality copies in town delivered right to your door. Just call Kinko's, the copy center. We pick up your originals and deliver clear, quality copies directly to you. No more traffic, no more lines. Depend on Kinko's. We pick up and deliver.
There's the man who just scored the CU touchdown. Backup quarterback Vance Joseph. On a 13-yard run. Mitch Berger kicking off for CU. And back to receive it, Jerome Madison and Skip Leach. Berger with another boomer. And Madison decides not to run it out.
We mentioned on the last touchdown run by Vance Joseph that it was close when he let this ball go. Good job of riding the fullback. Now watch as he crosses the goal line. There. Now he's in the end zone. It was close, but he's in the end zone. Had that been ruled a fumble, Missouri would have had the ball on their 20-yard line. Four plays, 27 yards, less than 2 minutes, and Vance Joseph from 15 yards for the TD.
First and 10 for Mizzou at the 20. The quarterback is still Phil Johnson. And the running back right there is still Ronnell Cahill. And he still can't get any yardage. Maybe one. fact, the whole Missouri offense has been very still all afternoon. Well, you saw a stunning contrast right there. A bunch of Buffs fans enjoying the afternoon, followed by Bob Stull, who's not enjoying one bit of it, the coach of the Missouri Tigers. Second and 10 for Mizzou. Phil Johnson complete to Cahill. He is whomped. And then three more Buffs bring him down at the 25. The initial hit was made by Greg Thomas, and that slowed down Cahill enough so that his teammates can come over and close out the play.
Again, see you in the base defense. Cahill will catch the ball. Thomas sits and waits. Didn't wrap him up. Gave him a pretty good jolt. Missouri has just not been able to throw the ball downfield. A couple of things. Secondary has disguised their coverages, and the pass rush has prevented Phil Johnson from having a lot of time.
It's third and six. 5:15 to go in the third quarter. Johnson overthrows Cahill with another good rush from Chad Brown and Ronnie Wolfork, the two outside linebackers. They've done a great job this year filling in for the two All-Americans who left, who graduated. Canavis McGee and Alfred Williams, both playing in the pros this year. McGee with the New York Giants and Alfred Williams for the Cincinnati Bengals. Mizzou will punt the ball. Plunkett will punt it, and Chris Hudson will return it for the Buffs. Hudson from his own 33. Dances his way across the 45 up to the 48. So the Buffs with a 34-0 lead, 5 minutes to go in the third quarter. That punt by Plunkett was 43 yards. The return by Hudson, 15. Boy, it must be nice to know for the Buffs special teams coaches that they've got Chris Hudson, Darian Hagan, and Rico Smith, who can all return a punt and all have the capability to break the long one. Vance Joseph still at quarterback for the Buffs. Kent Call back in the game at running back, and he gets the call across midfield down to the Missouri 49-yard line. Tim Burke, the tackle.
You've seen Bill McCartney in the first four games alternate Kent Call and Lamont Warren. Warren's had an outstanding afternoon here so far, but we also want Kent Call to get in the game and have a chance to show what he can do. McCartney has said that he doesn't necessarily have to have one of those kids playing the starting role. He's happy playing both.
Tell you what's nice about this team, they use everybody. They give it to 3-4 different running backs. They throw to 3-4-5 different receivers. Everybody stays fresh all year long. Vance Joseph down to the Mizzou 45, call it a gain of four. Major and McDonald, the tackles. Speaking of spreading it around, the Buffs have a new fullback in the ballgame. As you take a look at Darryl Major of Missouri, the new fullback in the game is Tony Senna, the senior from San Antonio. A special team standout. Maybe he'll get a carry or two today. That's Kent Call on this play. Stays on his feet. Stopped and stood upright at the 35-yard line by Maurice Benson.
Well, speaking of Tony Zinna, he leads Kent Call right through the hole. The lead, and when you run this play, you've got to have a fullback that roots out those linebackers. Tough to see, but Call breaks into the secondary and picks up more yardage.
Enough for a first down. Joseph to the air, deep, wide open. Westbrook, can he get in? Yes! Caught it at about the two, and then just stepped his way through a defender into the end zone. His second touchdown catch of the day.
Well, I don't think we're going to see the dogs called off here this afternoon for obvious reasons. Play action fake. Westbrook right up the seam. There's a wide receiver who runs a comeback to the top side of the screen. That draws the corner. The ball took forever. Westbrook said, all right, out of step into the end zone, and the Buffs have their 40th point.
A very casual Michael Westbrook. The extra point is good, and the score balloons to 41-0, CU's favorite. We're going to take a break. We'll be right back.
Subway, bells go off, and they think, good sandwich. We don't deep fry or freeze dry. Everything's fresh. Each morning, I slice tomatoes, onions. I even bake the bread. These days, people think a lot about what food to eat. Nothing's more honest than a good sandwich. So if the body's a temple, this is the place to come when the temple gets hungry.
For some of the best sandwiches anywhere, visit the Subway near you.
After 5 p.m., buy any regular footlong and soda and get the second footlong for 99 cents.
You got your dreams, your big ideas. You want them all to come true. But can you depend on your bank to really help you through? Yes, you can. Yes, you can. You give you all in all that you do. But can you depend on your bank to do the same for you? Yes, you can. Yes, you can.
Shapiro and Dave Logan at Folsom Field. Dave, you think Colorado is giving a little shot to the ribs here, going to the air with a 34-0 lead?
Well, I don't think, based on what happened last year, that either coach, if they got ahead, would pull the reins in a bit. I think you'll see Colorado still be aggressive offensively, and this will heighten the relationship between the two teams and the excitement that you'll see in the next few years.
Once again, no return for Missouri on the kickoff. Let's take a look at that last touchdown.
Michael Westbrook, again, is a great talent, a redshirt freshman out of Detroit. Vance Joseph kind of throws this thing up, and Westbrook has to wait for it to come down. You see linebackers, and you've seen linebackers chasing Westbrook most of the day. In that particular case, it was Kent Gardner, the outside backer. They've been able to isolate Westbrook on linebackers all day. Four plays, 52 yards, a minute and 38 seconds it took them, and now we'll see what Missouri can do. I think CU's game plan, both offensively and defensively, it's the best we've seen this year.
Westbrook with a touchdown catch against Stanford 2 weeks ago, and two more today. Phil Johnson on that out pattern has Skip Leach at the 25-yard line. A gain of five. Greg Thomas, the defender.
Skip Leach was a quarterback formerly, now shifted to wide receiver, so he's got that I'll make you miss mentality. Didn't particularly work there, but he's a good athlete.
Tell you what impressed me in his bio. In 4 years of high school, he never missed a day. Perfect attendance. That time the pass is incomplete, intended for Jerome Madison.
You look out and you're seeing a lot of guys that you're familiar with if you're a CU fan. Wolfwork, there's Bickert in your screen. First team defense. And I think you'll see the first team defense stay in the game well into the fourth quarter. Bill McCartney would like to get this shutout.
Sending a message to Mizzou after last year's controversial fifth down game. Missouri with a third and five situation on its own 25-yard line. Four wideouts. And Phil Johnson falls back into the shotgun. Boy, that field is spread out. Look at that picture. Penalty flags. This almost looks like a game you'd play in intramurals.
Dead ball.
Everybody go
delay,
deep.
5 yards, repeat, third down.
Yeah, but the good thing in intramural is you can always quit. You can just go in. We've got another quarter left. You see Oklahoma leading Texas in Dallas 7-0. Sooners are unbeaten. Texas looking for their first win of the year.
Yeah, but it doesn't matter in that rivalry. It
really doesn't.
No matter the disparity between the two teams, Texas always plays its best game of the year against its heated rival, Oklahoma. 2:37 to go in the third quarter. Missouri with a 3rd and 10, and Johnson keeps it. Fumble. CU has the ball. Chad Brown brought down at the 20-yard line. The Buffs just keep sticking it to him.
Well, if it hasn't been homely much of the afternoon, it's fixing to get real ugly. Johnson, this is a called keeper. Gets hit by Hamilton and Joel Steed from behind. Chad Brown realizes the ball is loose, picks it up, and then thinks about turning it into a running back.
Chad Brown, the junior out of Altadena, California, sociology major. Played inside linebacker last year because McGee and Williams had a stranglehold on the outside spots, but now he's been switched to the outside and doing very well. Vance Joseph brought down at the 15-yard line, a gain of 5 on a play that didn't look like it was going anywhere, but Joseph squeaked 5 yards out of it.
I'll tell you, Sharon Washington is walking back to the Missouri huddle with his hands on his hips. Eric Mitchell cracked back from the outside and almost decapitated Washington. Mitchell's about 160 pounds, but when you don't see him coming, it feels like 260. Take a look at the top of the screen. Bam! Oh, Sharon Washington. I don't know what I'm laughing at. That's not funny. Really took one from the diminutive Mitchell.
2nd and 5 for the Buffs. Reverse. There's Eric Mitchell. He's in. Touchdown, CU. The Buffs don't care that they're up 41-0. They're still throwing the trick plays at Mizzou.
Mitchell is the fastest CU player. They've timed him at 4.25. And once he catches the football, he could have literally walked into the end zone. We've got an injured Missouri player. That's Lance Knoll, I believe, the outside linebacker. Got to find ways to get the football into Eric Mitchell's hands.
Well, as Jimmy Durante said, everybody wants to get into the act today, and everybody has.
Check that. It's John Watkins, the defensive end for the Tigers.
Well, I don't blame him for wanting to come off the field, whether he's injured or not. This extra point will make it 48-0 if it's successful, and Pat Bluteau is kicking it for the first time today for the Buffs. Bluteau got a lot of action for the Buffs last year as their place kicker. This year, not much, with Jim Harper doing most of the duty. Bluteau, a pretty good kicker, though. Barefooted, puts it through. And it is CU 48 and Missouri nothing, with a minute 41 still to go in the third quarter. If you're into point spreads, the game opened up a 15-point advantage in CU's favor, and it shot up to 18 when the odds makers got a hold of the information that Missouri would be missing 3 of its starters. 18 points was not enough. 47 points was not enough, because right now it's 48-0. There's Eric Mitchell. Ran in that last touchdown.
They tried him a tailback. They tried him a wide receiver. He was a tailback in high school, but maybe a little bit small to take the constant pounding there. And so he'll play wide receiver, I think, for the most part of his career.
Well, be sure to join Dan Reeves and me each Monday evening at 6:30 for the Dan Reeves Show. This Monday, our guest will be standout Broncos linebacker Carl Mecklenburg. The coach and I will also take a preview of next week's showdown game with the Kansas City Chiefs. That's the Dan Reeves Show, Mondays at 6:30, right here on Channel 4. The home of the Broncos. And there are seats available at all of the Dan Reeves shows if you'd like to come into the studio and watch it live. Just give us a call. Jerome Madison and Skip Leach to receive the kickoff. Berger puts it out of bounds behind the end zone. Let's take another look at that Eric Mitchell touchdown.
You can see the Missouri defense really flowing to stop the option. And right there, once Mitchell catches the football, look outside. What do you see? Same thing Eric Mitchell saw. Nothing. Walks into the end zone.
He was celebrating back at the 5-yard line. He knew he was in. Scoring drive after the Chad Brown recovered fumble. Just two plays to go 20 yards. So Mizzou will try it again. Every time we turn around, they're first and 10 from their own 20-yard line. Here's the final from Notre Dame. The Irish put a licking on Pitt, 42-7. The Panthers, a top 20 team, manhandled by Notre Dame. And right here, there's your score. A lot of time left, but not enough for Missouri to get back into it, that's for sure. Second and 9. Again they run, and again they fumble. And CU has the ball again. I saw 4 or 5 black jerseys fall on it. Let's see if a Mizzou Tiger is able to sneak in. No, it's CU's ball. The third time Missouri has fumbled the ball away today.
Missouri came into the game with running backs nicked up a bit, and thus they really haven't been able to establish much. Beekert almost knocks the ball out, but it looked like it just came out as he was going down. And Eric Hamilton, we think, was the buff that got the recovery.
Well, with such a big lead, the Buffs are going to their third string quarterback now, Cordell Stewart from Marrero, Louisiana. Now in, number 10. And Darnell Brooks is in, a running back. The fake goes to Brooks. Stewart throws, but it's dropped by Sean Embry. Well, I'll tell you somebody that's going to take Sean to task for that, his brother John, who's an assistant coach, a volunteer assistant coach for the Buffs. His brother John played tight end here 1983 to 1986, and his dad John might also have something to say about it too. The elder John Embry played for the Broncos and for CU also. Second and 10. It'll be 3rd and 8 for the Buffs. And into the ball game now for the first time this afternoon at tight end is Christian Faria. Young man from Northridge, California. Stewart. A lot of room. He decides to run it. Almost brought down at the 10. Finally brought down at the 2. Cordell Stewart almost ran that ball in from the 27-yard line. And I think the play was designed to be a pass.
Oh, certainly it was. But what a difference once he decides to make the defense play him. Cordell Stewart at 6'2 and about 205 pounds. And you'll be able to see the strength of this young man breaking tackles. He runs a lot like a fullback. And yet he can throw the ball, and he, along with Vance Joseph, the future quarterback for Colorado football.
Boy, this coaching staff loves Cordell Stewart. And that's the end of the third quarter. The Buffs will begin the final frame with the ball on the Missouri 2-yard line and with a first down. Let's take a break. The Buffs pitching a shutout.
company can learn a lot in 125 years? Valvoline has. You learn in the lab, you learn on the road, you learn on the racetrack. As you learn, you make your product better. And better, and better. Today's Valvoline will keep your engine cleaner than ever before. And cleaner means more protection against engine wear. 125 years of quality. That's why people who know use Valvoline.
Are you a real Broncos fan?
You like to wear crazy Broncos clothing.
We want to see.
Play Kodak Fan Pick. Just send in your picture dressed up in your best Broncos clothing to this address. Then watch Broncos Beat to see if you're a winner.
Today's game is brought to you by State Farm Insurance and by First Federal Bank, both proud companies for Colorado, and also by Coors, by Subway Shops, and by Kinko's.
Les Shapiro and Dave Logan, Folsom Field, the start of the fourth quarter. It's 48-0, but the Buffs are about to make it more. That's Tony Senna in for the touchdown. Tony Senna, the backup fullback for the Buffs. That might be his first touchdown ever in a college uniform.
Well, he hasn't had much time to play. He's been a great special teams player and a good kid, too.
Well, you had him on the McCartney show a couple of weeks ago. He was a pleasure. That's Bluto with the extra point. And it's 55-0. Tony Senna, congratulations all around on the sideline.
You're seeing Tony Senna's first touchdown of his career, as last mentioned. It's got to be nice. Senior, he's worked hard his entire career. He's actually, before this year, only carried the football 8 times. There you see the statistics through 3 quarters. Colorado with 30 first downs. We'll be checking on that for school record inventory. Almost 400 yards rushing through 3 quarters. We've got some cheerleaders who are going to be doing significant push-ups for the next 30 minutes or so. Chips, or Ralphie, whoever that is, just decided to do some cheating-type sit-ups. Get up and do push-ups.
Yeah, they're going to spend a little time in the jacuzzi tonight. Get some heat on those sore muscles.
One thing about Missouri fans here, they're dressed in black and gold, so as they leave the field and go home, they can at least not stick out like sore thumbs. When Nebraska and Oklahoma come in here, although the score usually not like this, you know who they are when they leave. A lot of black and gold today.
A lot of people are leaving the stadium already. 55-0, and we just started the fourth quarter. Speaking of firsts, Eric Mitchell scored the touchdown before Tony Senna, and that was also Eric Mitchell's first touchdown of his college career. Mitch Berger will be kicking off for the Buffs. And as we've told you about 8 times previous, Jerome Madison and Skip Leach will be returning. Bit of a squibber by Berger this time. Leach with an opportunity. Gets it up to the 22. Return of approximately 20 yards. That last scoring drive, 4 plays after the recovered fumble. Took just a little over a minute. And Senna took it in. Buffs with a lot of second and third stringers in on defense now. Darius Holland, Jeff Bruner, Brian Dyett on the defensive line. And a new Missouri quarterback, Jeff Handy. A freshman out of Blue Springs, Missouri. There tries to hit Jerome Madison. It's incomplete.
Yeah.
Well, let's go down to the field. Mark McIntosh has something for us. Mark?
Thank you very much. Les, earlier in the ballgame, you talked about Darian Hagan going over 100 yards. Well, that's the first time since the Stanford game of last year that Darian Hagan has gained more than 100 yards. You remember back in 89, he rushed for more than 1,000, but he struggled since then, but he's over 100 today. Back to you guys.
Thanks, Mac. Running the ball for Missouri there was Joe Freeman, another freshman. Well, if you're wondering what's going on in the National League Championship Series in baseball, Atlanta in the fifth inning beating the Pittsburgh Pirates 6-2. And here's a football score for you. Air Force, boy, sinking Navy 46-6 in the fourth, and that one is in Annapolis, Maryland. This is Jerome Madison. And we've got a penalty flag.
Been a lot of face masks calls here today. I think we've had five or six of them.
Face mask, 5 yards against the defense, first down.
Easy to make that call. When the body goes upfield and the head turns around behind, you know that's not a normal procedure.
Well, let me ask you, you played so many years. Does it hurt as much as it looks like it does?
It can, sure. It can really wrench your neck. It just depends on the individual play. But it's never fun.
First down for Mizzou. Handy? Not so handy on that one. The intended receiver was Kenny Holly, but it was thrown behind him. Well, these two teams met for the first time in 1930, and they've played almost every year since, 56 times. And they're going to play the conference opener against each other the next 3 years also. Next year, of course, it'll be in Columbia, Missouri at Faurot Field. And Missouri will remember this game when they get the Buffs at home next year. Second and 10. Handy complete. This time he has Holly, and Holly is up to the 44. It was Ryan Thomas on the tackle.
Handy doesn't figure to get a lot of playing time the next couple of years unless something happens to Phil Johnson. Holly with a miss. Ryan Thomas right there out of Fort Collins Poudre High School. A couple of young quarterbacks actually transferred from Missouri after they found out that Phil Johnson was going to be the man.
Mizzou, not much on the ground there on first down. Well, the biggest CU route in this series, we'll tell you about that in a second. First, we'll tell you that when CU holds an opponent to less than 100 yards, the Buffs are undefeated. That only makes sense. Well, the biggest route in this series for CU, just 2 years ago, 1989, the Buffs beat Mizzou 49-3. This one will eclipse that. And the two freshmen hook up. Handy to Joe Freeman. This is one of those afternoons where Mizzou wishes it brought along its full squad. But they only travel with 60. This is very reminiscent of the game we did here 3 weeks ago when CU did a number on Minnesota. 49-0. CU sure to move up in the rankings today. They came in ranked 25th in the Associated Press poll. This should bring them up a couple notches. Complete that time. To number 11, Kenneth Dunn, the wide receiver out of East St. Louis, Illinois. Julian Hayward, the tackle.
This is a nice throw from Handy, just a seam pattern. Missouri with three wide receivers from the left side. They flood the zone. And you see Dunn with a nice catch. Make Spencer Coulter miss. And Missouri trying to get their first score of the afternoon.
Kid throws a nice pass, doesn't he?
Sure does.
First and goal from the 9. Michael Washington gets it down almost to the 5-yard line. Mark McIntosh, what do you have?
Well, if anybody out there is wondering what the record is for most points in a ball game by the CU Buffs, it's 65 set against the Arizona Wildcats at Tucson 33 years ago, back in 1958. These guys weren't even a twinkle in anybody's eye when that happened, but they might have a shot to break that record today.
Darian Hagan so bored he's reading a magazine. Second and goal from the 5. This is Freeman again. Is he in? Yes. The side judges say yes. So Missouri finally gets on the board for the first time all day with 11:47 to go in the final quarter. I'm sure even though the Buffs were up by 55 points, they're not too pleased about this. When you're so close to throwing a shutout, you want it badly.
Good job here just ducking behind the blockers and keeping his feet moving. Joe Freeman out of Richardson, Texas, gets into the end zone. It's okay to be happy. Pretty good drive. 440.
Extra point is good from Jeff Jackie. So Missouri has its first 7 points of the afternoon, but they're still down by 48.
I hope when people see Subway, bells go off and they think, good sandwich. We don't deep fry or freeze dry. Everything's fresh. Each morning, I slice tomatoes, onions. I even bake the bread. These days, people think a lot about what food to eat. Nothing's more honest than a good sandwich. So if the body's a temple, this is the place to come when a temple gets hungry.
For some of the best sandwiches anywhere, visit the Subway near you.
After 5 p.m., buy any regular footlong and soda and get the second footlong for 99 cents.
This is Pat.
I try to be the best at whatever I do, and that goes for this business. That's why my name's on the door. I want our customers to know that they can count on me, that we'll be here for them, now and down the road.
John Elway Honda, it's a whole new buying experience. Catch your best deal now on brand new 92 Honda Accords only at John Elway Honda. Choose from the region's best selection of Accords, including hard to find 5-speeds. Plus, save big on Honda Civics during our final 91 clearance now at John Elway Honda, west of I-25 and 104th.
On my first job back in the 60s, I traveled out west a lot. The only place original Coors was sold, which made me a very popular guy. Here's Steve swapping me his old stereo for a case. I think he took me. I used to bring Coors back in my trunk. It was like home delivery, fresh from the Rockies. Ta-da! After I got married, I changed jobs, but not beers. Hey, the best things in life never change.
Colorado with a 48-point lead, 11:47 to go in what has been a very long ball game. Charles Johnson returning the kickoff and brings it up to about the 27-yard line. Well, this is a nice way to open the conference schedule for CU, and they're going to need a little momentum because next week they play the Oklahoma Sooners at Oklahoma's place. That last scoring drive, best drive of the afternoon for Mizzou. 9 plays, 78 yards, and Joe Freeman scored the TD. Well, how do you see next week?
I think it's going to be tough on them. I don't think the odds are insurmountable, and as you mentioned, they gained a lot of confidence by their play here this afternoon.
Cordell Stewart, the freshman from Louisiana, gets it up to the 37. He might have first down yardage.
And again, at 6'2 and over 200 pounds, the impressive thing about him, aside from his quickness, it breaks tackles. That straight arm just knocks somebody to the ground. Cordell Stewart, excellent arm. Good presence for a freshman.
High school All-American. He came into this game averaging 9 yards a rush. He's played a little this year so far. That's Darnell Brooks out of TJ Thomas Jefferson High School. A couple of years ago, led TJ to the state title in the 6A classification. He was playing defensive back in spring ball and early this year in the fall. But when CU had a little trouble at running back, they moved Brooks back. And I think he's a lot more comfortable there than he was at defensive back. First down. The option. And Stewart opts to keep it. And a good decision. Inside the 45, down to the Mizzou 42. Jermaine Wilkins, the step.
And again, not to overstate it, but watch the pace and patience Cordell Stewart has. Most young guys would pitch it right there. And yet he ducks back underneath, keeps the football, makes the right choice, and picks up a first down. He looks like he's played in the option attack on a collegiate level for at least a couple of years. He didn't look like a freshman right out of high school.
He also doesn't look like his size, 6'2", 205, the way he fluidly moves. First down. This is Brooks again, running wide. Might have a yard. Travis McDonald, the tackle. I think CU would be happy to have the clock run down very quickly here. A 55-7 lead. You don't want to get anybody hurt going into Oklahoma. And Missouri wouldn't mind that either. They probably want to get out of here as quickly as possible. Under 10 minutes to go, fourth quarter. Stewart on the keeper. Inside the 35. Gang tackled, and among those making the tackle, Javon Lenhart. Bill McCartney, you can take the rest of the afternoon off, Bill. You don't have to put the headphones on. You don't have to strategize. Cordell Stewart, pretty nice afternoon. Averaging a little better than 11 yards a carry so far. Third and three for the Buffs. A lot of option today. This is Brooks. Has some room. Inside the 20, down to the 16-yard line before Jermaine Wilkins grabs him.
Well, we've talked about it all afternoon. You can be in perfect position to defense the option, but you have to make the plays. Stewart, the option to Brooks. There's a tackle that has to be made. Jason Oliver just kind of whiffs Darnell Brooks. And that's what drives defensive coordinators mad. You get them right where they have to be, and yet with great athletic ability, the offense is able to make the play.
Darnell Brooks, a communication major. Stewart fumbles the snap, makes a nice recovery, though, and gets it back to the line of scrimmage. Will Bass falls on top of him. This scene is very reminiscent of the Minnesota Gophers a few weeks ago. Bob Stull, not a very happy man.
He's done a good job. You can regroup next week. They go home. They have their homecoming game against Oklahoma State. Unlike last year, after the CU game, they played Nebraska and lost 69-13.
Second and 10. Stewart, inadvisable pitch, is picked up by Missouri. Missouri will get the ball. That's Mike Jadlow. But you cannot... You cannot advance that after you pick it up. Not in college ball. In the pros, anything's game. He could have gone in for the score. Not in college ball, however.
Now, Cordell Stewart here ducks back inside, and when he does, his running back gets knocked down. Stewart doesn't see him, makes the pitch to the invisible man. And you can see the ball picked up. You cannot advance it because it was behind the line of scrimmage. And you can see Darnell Brooks really took one in the chops from Marcus Martin, and nobody for the pitch.
Quarterback for Missouri is the second string freshman, Jeff Handy. He gives it off to Jerome Madison. I think he lost the ball, but Missouri recovers it. He got hit by two Buffs, including Tate Nelson, and coughed it up. but he caught it in midair and fell down.
Missouri now just trying to run the ball to establish a little bit of a running game, obviously out of the contest. But you can see Jerome Madison lost the handle. Lots of black jerseys. Coaches like that. And Don Wright got the ball back for the Tigers.
Second and three for the Tigers from their own 22. Another fumble. And again, Missouri is able to fall on it. What is that, five fumbles on the day for Mizzou? Boy, when it ain't going right, it ain't going right. Nebraska with a nice conference opener.
Speaking of ain't going right, ain't going right.
Boy, oh boy. What do you think for Oklahoma State?
Well, it's
two field goals and a safety?
Yeah, they've got a young team. Wyoming ahead of Utah and Laramie 29-14 the second quarter. Pat Jones has got a very young team in Stillwater that's just trying to figure out how to win.
Third and five. Mizzou picks up the first down yardage. The new quarterback who ran the ball is Brian Solly. Another freshman, this one out of Jackson, Tennessee. Sally with very good speed. He runs a 4.42 40. Hasn't had any playing time yet this year, however. He's a freshman out of Jackson, Tennessee, a pre-business major. Whistles on the field. And the referee wants the CU Buffs to get back along the sideline. You're getting too close to the field, fellas. You've got 11 men out here. You don't need any more. Not up 55-7.
Back up from the sideline to the Colorado team.
First and 10 for Mizzou. Once again, it's Jerome Madison, and he's across the 45. And he has another first down. William Polk in the ball game now from Montbello High School made the tackle. Sophomore. Another Big Eight conference score. Kansas beating Kansas State 9-3 in the fourth quarter. Both those schools struggling programs the last few years, but they're both off to 3-1 starts. Under 6 minutes to go. First down, Mizzou. Sally almost brought down, escapes, and completes the pass to Kenny Holly. The man who almost brought him down for the sack was DeShannon Campbell, the fine freshman linebacker from Houston, Texas.
Solly does a nice job here just avoiding the rush. It looked like he was going to be sacked by DeShannon Campbell and got away, and wide receivers get crunched when the ball hangs up like this, but Holly hangs on.
I can't wait to see DeShannon Campbell when he has some experience.
He's going to be a good player. Good job of hanging on to the football by Holly.
Campbell is 6'6", 250 pounds, and moves like a running back. But the pass was completed, and Missouri has a first down. Once again, a good rush. Sally almost has the ball intercepted. The rush was put on by Spencer Coulter and Rodell Guest from the linebacker position. Or as he likes to be called, House Guest. Rodell left school last year. Tried a career at pro basketball with the WBL entry in Memphis, Tennessee. Didn't pan out for him, so he came back to school, registered for a few classes, and came back out for the football team. Sally going deep, nowhere near a receiver. Excuse me, that's Handy back in the ball game. Missouri playing musical quarterbacks now. Handy overthrows his receiver by a good 10 yards. It'll be third down for Mizzou. 10 yards to go in CU territory. Missouri came into this game beating Illinois, tying Indiana, beating Memphis State. We thought it would be a tougher game than this. That pass incomplete. Fourth down situation for Missouri. Looks like they're going to go for it. A view from the CU sideline. This stadium getting awfully empty. We've got 5:03 to go in the final quarter. Handy in the shotgun. Good pressure again. Handy steps up, but no receiver in the area. Pressure once again from Rodell Guest and Spencer Coulter. Blake Anderson also in there. Blake, of course, the nephew of CU great Bobby Anderson.
And the son of CU great, former CU great Dick Anderson.
Dick went on to play have a fine career with the Miami Dolphins. We're going to take a break at Folsom Field. The Buffs lead it 55-7.
Say, have you ever seen one of these? It's First Federal Bank's new Visa checking card. Use it like a credit card, but it works like a check. Your charges are paid automatically from your First Federal checking account. When you get the new Visa checking card, you can get a new First Federal checking account and your first box of checks free. With all that and the new Visa checking card, why not make First Federal your bank? Since 1885, First Federal, Colorado's convenient consumer bank.
Go for size, not
we don't
location.
Make enough.
A mortgage is a mortgage.
Let HUD set you straight if everyone is offering you advice on buying your dream home. Let real estate pros help you buy a HUD home. They'll do everything from finding homes you can afford to doing the paperwork. And HUD pays their fees.
Doing with their presentation.
We're ready.
When your department has to deliver, call Kinko's, the copy center. We take care of the copies so you can take care of business. Now you can get the highest quality copies in town delivered right to your door. Just call Kinko's, the copy center. We pick up your originals and deliver clear quality copies directly to you. No more traffic, no more lines. Depend on Kinko's. We pick up and deliver.
Well, while we were away, CU ran one play. It was Darnell Brooks for a 7-yard gain. So it's second and three. The CU Buffs, you're not going to believe this. They have 452 yards rushing today. Just on the ground, 452 yards. This is Brooks again, another big hole. Finally brought down at the Missouri 41. Jermaine Wilkins, the tackle. They could have 500 yards rushing today at this game. They've got the time to do it. 4:16 to go.
Boy, Darnell Brooks was a good player in high school, but has really been bounced back and forth between offense and defense and trying to find a spot. He has looked good here this afternoon. And kids really have to take advantage of any opportunity to show what they can do.
First and 10 for the Buffs. This is Cordell Stewart on the caper. Inside the 40. Down to the 37. Travis McDonald. The tackle.
McDonald making the stop.
Three and a half minutes to go. The Buffs up. 55-7. Well, that kid has the right idea. Game's not close. Grab a little shut-eye. And maybe he can stay up a little later. Stewart again on the option. Around right end, inside the 30, out of bounds at the 29, and that'll be good for another CU first down. Last time CU had more than 500 yards rushing, it was 2 years ago against Kansas State. They had 518 yards. It's possible they could do better than that today. First man through, bowling his way up. Scott Phillips from Monument, Colorado. Sophomore, 6'2", 220 pounds. He's listed as a tight end. He lined up at fullback that time.
Colorado's got to be nearing some sort of school mark, you would think, for first downs.
Another first down that time from Phillips. The Buffs on the 17-yard line. This is Darnell Brooks, tripped up. Gain of one. Tim Burke did the tripping.
Tripped up on the play by Harrison. Carrying the 16. Second and five.
Well, a lot of firsts today. Wide receiver Robbie James caught his first collegiate pass. Eric Mitchell and Tony Senna score their first collegiate touchdowns for the Buffs. A lot of ball players right now getting their first action of the year. 2 minutes to go. Stewart once again gives to Phillips, the first man through, and Phillips is down to the 10-yard line. A gain of six. Here are the folks that put it all together for you today, the audio and the video, bringing you the pictures and the sound. Great crew at Channel 4. A little extracurricular activity on the field. I'm sure Missouri very, very frustrated by now. Approaching the 1 minute mark. The sooner the better. A few more of the folks bringing you the game. Seven. 45 seconds to go. Think the Buffs will try and take it in, Dave, or do you take it easy on Missouri here? Darnell Brooks isn't taking it easy. Down to the 6-yard line. He wants that goal line.
I think they'll line up, at regular speed and just probably run a play. They won't hurry to get to the line of scrimmage, however.
Clock winding down, under 30 seconds. Well, CU didn't need any fifth down this year to make its point. Not close today. In fact, CU didn't need fourth down in a lot of cases. The fans want the Buffs to take it in one more time, but the Buffs decide to take it easy on Missouri. Down the ball. The clock winds down. We are at zero, and this ball game is over. CU opens the conference schedule with a win. We'll be right back to wrap things up.